just about to make their way out onto the pitch here at Elland Road. Leeds United have scored in every game they've played in 2024 in all competitions as they look to bounce straight back up to the Premier League. Hull still have an eye on the playoff places with eight games for them to go. Another huge game in the Championship under the lights. Sit back and enjoy with Lucy Ward and Jim Proudfoot.
Thank you, Faye, and good evening to you. Welcome to a Yorkshire derby to savour. First between the two sides here for 4 years. The Tigers making the journey west and the East riding after what's already been an outstanding day for them. Leeds chasing the title, but having had to sit through Leicester and Ipswich victories today, they now start the night 4 points off the top. Daniel Farke's juggernaut hit a rare bump in the road in Watford on Friday. The Whites dropping points for only the second time in 2024, but salvaging something with Matteo Joseph's late equaliser. 2 points dropped or one gained? Impossible to tell just yet. Their home form has been sensational. There's only been one game they haven't won here since early September, with wins against Ipswich and Leicester in that run. But it is a run they simply have to maintain. Hull have been tough to beat and better on the road than at home. Wins at the King Power and St Mary's, testament to that. And after the three teams above them in the table all lost today, they can climb to seventh tonight within 3 points of a playoff place with a game in hand. This by no means a dead rubber as far as the Tigers are concerned. Well, these are the two teams. Leeds have Melier in goal. Back four of Byron Mampadu, Roden and Fierpo, Gray and Kamara, James, Ruta and Somerville, with Bamford up front. Allsops in goal for Hull. They too have remodelled the back four. Slater, Coyle, Jones and Giles. Morton playing alongside Seri in midfield. Philogene on the right. Ozan Tufan on the left. And Fabio Carvalho alongside Omer, playing through the middle, but ostensibly he's going to be a 4-2-4-0 formation because they'll be more than happy to sit back with bodies behind the ball. And Lucy, you touched on it in your preview with Faye, the possession tonight. The two sides last met, it's a 0-0 draw. Joe Roden got sent off in that game and that would have had a part to play in it. But possession was actually 57-43 in Hull's favour. You expecting something similar to that tonight?
Do you know what, Jim? I really don't know what to expect just because of the games earlier on in the day. I do think that Leeds need to be high tempo and they need to make sure that they get on top really, really early in the game, because if they let Hull get control of the game, which they can in possession, then I think that the crowd, as well as being positive, they can be a little bit nervy and negative.
Well, the two captains, Ethan Ampadu and Louis Coyle, just going through the handshakes and the formalities with referee Josh Smith, who is one of the few officials who's taken charge of a Leeds defeat this season. Well, before the game starts, there will be a tribute to two Leeds fans, Kevin Spate and Christopher Loftus, who lost their lives in Istanbul ahead of the UEFA Cup semi-final with Galatasaray 24 years ago this week. Two men who will always be remembered. But the Hull players unite around the edge of the centre circle and their Leeds counterparts now do likewise, breaking out of their huddle. And Elland Road stands, applauds and remembers. Big screen away to our right hand side, Christopher Loftus and Kevin Spate, gone but never forgotten. An Easter weekend in which the Championship lead has chopped and changed. Leeds supremacy overhauled by Ipswich on Friday. Leicester top, then second, then top again until the last kick at Portman Road. But now that stoppage time knockout Suffolk punch means that Leeds are playing to get back within a point of the summit. With victory tonight, it's Hull that get us underway, and they're in all amber And kicking from right to left. Leeds attacking the Norman Hunter stand away to our right-hand side in this first half. Ahead of another night of Championship football on what's been an extraordinary weekend of EFL action. Every game with a twist and a turn. And you've heard the whole story unfold on Talksport and Talksport 2. Flegene starting on the left-hand side. It was a poor clearance by the Leeds back line. First sign of early nerves. Melier able to get there inside the six-yard box. Can clear. It's played forward again then by Coyle. Bouncing down in the midfield. Hammered away by Dan James towards halfway. But Hull have had the early possession and a lot of it in Leeds territory as well. Good ball played forward on the left-hand side of the penalty area. Melier thought about coming out and then stopped. Nozan Tufan making the run past him. Couldn't get on the end of the ball in time. It goes out of play for a Leeds goal kick.
Yeah, I mean, it's been all Hull the opening few seconds of the game, and Tufan gets himself forward. And the thing is that Melier, neither of them really wanted to go for the ball, and both sort of, not chickened out, but sort of left it in the end. And in the end, it just ran out for a goal kick.
A slight difference to what we were anticipating from a Hull perspective, incidentally. Filigena started on the left. Fabio Carvalho through the middle alongside Tufan, and Omer is playing on the right-hand side for Hull in this 4-2-4-0 formation, which might sound defensive, but they certainly will be more than prepared to get the bodies forward, as we've already seen. Kamara playing it back here for the hugely impressive youngster Archie Gray. Couldn't quite get the angle right on his ball forward, and it sails through to Hull goalkeeper Ryan Allsop away to our left-hand side, our right-hand side, sorry. Earlier today, Leicester beating Norwich by 3-1. And then Ipswich seeing off Southampton in a game in which they scored first, went 2-1 down, and then salvaged a victory with just about the last kick of the game from Jeremy Sarmiento. The table as it stands right now. Ipswich, 87 points with 6 games to go. Leicester, 85 with 7 games to go. And Leeds, 84 in their 7th last game. As Giles plays the ball forward down the Hull left, but won back easily on halfway by Roden. Stamford, Bamford couldn't get it under control, and Louis Coyle, he's able to work it back for his goalkeeper, Ryan Allsop. Here's Lucy Ward.
Yeah, you know, Ampadu playing at left centre-back, that's worked for Leeds, and he changed it on Friday night and brought Liam Cooper in, and Ampadu went into midfield, and it didn't quite work. Now, you'd sort of think that it'd go back and be as good as it was. That's not for Leeds. It is.
Gray, James Gray. Angle was tight. He's blazed it over the bar, but the first Leeds side of goal comes inside the opening 3 minutes.
Yeah, the thing about that is that with Sam Barron playing at right back, Archie Gray's now in central midfield, and that's obviously his preferred position, and it allows him to get forward, which he just did there, right in that inside right channel, and he struck the ball, and I think he just went for power, and it just rose as soon as he hit it. No real threat on Allsop's goal.
I think they were forcing to make him that change regarding Firpo the other night. He'd been on international duty with the Dominican Republic, playing in a game that had kicked off at 1 o'clock English time on Wednesday morning, so an 8 o'clock Friday night game after a transatlantic flight, not likely to be too easy for him. They got 25 minutes out of him, and Leeds arguably played their best football in that last 25 minutes of Vicarage Road when they'd made the change and Cooper had gone off and Firpo had come back on. And so they're playing pretty much the way that they finished that game from a defensive viewpoint. Here's Filigene making his way forward here for Hull inside the Leeds penalty area, but a strong challenge on him. We'll be able to get the ball away. Seri, former Fulham man, battling. And Leeds have done really well to get it forward with Ruta, and then Bamford comes to meet it. Good quick feet from him in his red boots. Laying it back again for Jorginho Ruta. 15 assists to his name this season.
Yeah, Ruta does well. Because what he does, Jimmy, he just works back. He worked right back on to the edge of his box, out of possession to win it back. I mean, he doesn't score enough goals for me, but the work that he does when Leeds have not got the ball, and obviously his assists, Leeds is really valuable to this team.
Now Kamara will play the ball down the Leeds left. Firpo with the deep delivery, but straight into the hands of the goalkeeper Ryan Allsop, who Hull signed in a £250,000 deal from Cardiff back in August. Another player who has limited Premier League experience in the past. He was on the books of Bournemouth at one stage and made a couple of appearances in top flight for them. It's Alfie Jones making the 200th appearance of his career. Plays it to Giles. Long ball four from Giles, who's a Premier League experience this season for Luton. Now turned forward by Leeds through the midfield for Gray towards Ethan Ampadu, and the Leeds skipper will bring it forward again.
Yeah, what you said about having no forwards, you're actually right. I know it sounds strange, but you've got Tufan and Carvalho, and then what they're forming a box in that with the two central midfielders in that central area, and that's just try and overload Leeds in those central areas, because Leeds like to go there before they go wide. And you know, it's obviously a defensive game plan from Rossini, but he knows he's got the players in possession when they win the ball back.
Now Giles found Morton, who played it back to his goalkeeper and then showed for the ball back into feet from Ryan Allsop. Allsop not wanting to take any chances against the Leeds press, went long, and as a result possession back with Leeds again, away to the left. Unbeaten in 14 league games, of which they've won 12, and if they can avoid defeat today, it'll be their longest unbeaten league run since 2009, 15 years ago they last went 15 unbeaten in the league. Well, that's a mark that they can emulate tonight. Glenn Kamara in the midfield. It's 0-0 in the early stages here at Ellen Road. Six gone on Talksport. As Ampadu plays it forward for Chris Somerville, who scored the latest in a long line of wonderful goals the other night for Leeds. Play back for Mellier. And out from the back now to Joe Roden. Roden down towards the touchline, then forced to turn back again under a little bit of pressure from Ozan Tufan. And he'll play it back inside his own penalty area once more for Mellier. He'll just trot out the box and then drive it left-footed, a long straight ball. Trying to get Bamford isolated against Coyle. And James having the run at Giles, but Allsop came to the edge of his own penalty area and was able to pick it up.
Yeah, you got ex-Leeds United, Louis Coyle, usually a right-back playing centre-back, the captain of Hull City. Known Louis since he was about 10 years old when he came through the academy and played in the first team. And he's just not used to playing there, so it'd be difficult for him. He needs to concentrate against Bamford, because Bamford's movement is unbelievable in the build-up. He's not really scored as many goals as he'd like to this season, but he certainly is a benefit to Leeds when they're building and when they're trying to get up the pitch.
Yeah, he was born in Hull. Louis Corber had his footballing formative years here. As Lucy says, he's a very young man. Still at primary school, was associated with the club here. A couple of dozen appearances for the first team before leaving Ellen Road back in 2017. Has proved to be a championship player of some repute. Seri down towards Giles, and Giles can bring it forward here for Hull. And the men in all amber working it forward through the midfield again. Philogene. And there's Seri turning it forward. Ozan Tufan just at cross purposes was expecting a ball to be played slightly shallower than that at a different angle, and as a result it goes through for Mellier, and we're through the opening 8 minutes. And a little bit of a phony war at the moment,
yes.
I think, Lucy.
Yeah.
Is neither side able to really engage with the other?
Yeah, a little bit cat and mouse. You can see that Hull are quite happy, the players, particularly in those central midfield areas, that are happy dealing with the ball under pressure and look to be passers, and they've got to be brave to get themselves on the ball, because they do overload Leeds in those central areas because of the way that they're playing. So they have to use that overload to get themselves up the pitch.
Ball's back with Seri, and now played through the midfield towards the left-hand side for Ryan Giles. It's the near touchline. Hull kick from right to left. Good challenge by Byron, winning it back for Leeds on halfway. Ruta. It looked as though he'd shown a little bit too much of it to Seri, but he was away from him, then drops his shoulder, gets past Morton. Thinks about pulling the trigger. Finds Somerville instead, getting towards the byline. First shot comes in, it's saved, and it's bubbled in on the rebound by Sam Byron. It's taken Leeds 9 minutes, and first blood is West Yorkshire's in this crucial Yorkshire derby.
I'll tell you what, Jim, that was all about Ruta. Now, what he's had to do, Ruta, he's had to drop, because he knows that Hull have got the overload in that central area, so he won the ball far too easy from a Hull point of view for Ruta to move himself from right deep, really up to sort of left of the area, and then gives the ball into Somerville. Somerville takes a touch, has a shot, it's actually well saved by Allsop, but Sam Byron, quickest to react as the ball's in the air, just jumps for it and gets on the end of it. And you know, after a positive start from Hull, first time really that Leeds have had any sort of attempt on goal, they've got themselves 1-0 up, and this has relaxed the crowd.
Well, such a fierce shot at the near post, well saved by Allsop. All he could do is get his hands behind it and beat it away, and it's all a question of who is going to get there first. And and it was Byram to bundle it in. But it is Jorginho Ruta's name that is being sung around Elland Road again for the part that he played, picking up the ball in the midfield and driving with real intent right through that whole midfield. Leeds 1, Hull 0 on TalkSport.
He just makes things happen, Jim Rute. It doesn't look like he's going to move with any sort of pace, but then he just manages to glide past players and it just opens the pitch up because he's sort of a diagonal run from bottom right to top left of the pitch.
Now Kamara with a sliding challenge on the edge of his own penalty area. Seri can pick up the loose ball and feed it out towards the right. Yeah, three in the middle, but Oma couldn't find them. And Leeds will be able to clear out towards Ruter again in that midfield area. But he's just lost the battle of the two number 24s against Seri. A stumble from Morton, not the first tonight. Losing his footing and allowing Archie Gray to bring the ball forward for Leeds. And the teenager turns it back for Roden. Leeds with such a good record this season when they've scored first. It's happened in 21 previous league games and they've gone on to win 19 of those 21 and drawn the other two. So they've only dropped 4 points all season from 1-0 up. And that's the advantage that Sam Byram has given them inside the opening 10 minutes tonight.
Yeah, what Hull don't need to do is just let the game run away with them. It's easy when you're at Elland Road when you concede one to concede another one. So actually they've responded quite well. You can tell that they used to being brave, getting on the ball, you know, getting themselves open for a pass. You know, Liam Rossini wants them to keep possession. It's difficult when you're away from home at Elland Road, but they're just trying to do that. And they just didn't really deal with that moment in the box and it resulted in a Leeds goal.
Call to Jones, to Morton. And back for Coyle again. Out towards the right-hand side for Regan Slater. Slater playing it back to Coyle. It's the mark of any Liam Rossini side that they're going to be very good in possession. They're going to have a lot of the ball. We talked in the build-up about the fact that they dominated possession when the two sides last met, and it's that bravery that has brought them some outstanding success on the road this season. They've got the best away record in the division outside of the top four, and they've won four of their last five away games, only dropping points at Preston in that time.
Yeah, and they're keeping the ball since they've conceded, and Leeds actually are letting them have it because they're not hurting Leeds where they were in possession of the ball. They knock it around the back four into central midfield and back out again, and Leeds are just moving along and just shifting their shape across and just not allowing Hull to get any further. As soon as they do go further, it kicks it out for a throw-in.
Yeah, it was Abdelkadir Omur that couldn't keep the ball in over on that far touchline, a player that Hull spent £4 million on. Right from Trabzonspor, for whom he made more than 200 appearances and nearly 20 in Europe. Playing his trade in the Championship now. Coyle working it back for his goalkeeper, Allsop, already beaten tonight by the goal from Sam Byram, only his second of the season. And his first since he led it against Watford back in September. Leeds 1, Hull 0. 13 minutes gone here on TalkSport.
Nice, good goal for Sam as well. Just his wife's just given birth to their first child, his girlfriend, so he'll be happy about that. I didn't see his celebration, so that'll be quite interesting, but he'll be happy to score, particularly from that right back area. He's quite an attack minded full back, has played in wide positions, so we'll always just try and push on if Leeds have got the ball on the opposite side.
Yeah, very versatile, has the ability to easily play on either flank. Hull able to bring the ball away from the back now with Ryan Giles. Giles working down the left-hand touchline. Couldn't find Jaden Philogene. Leeds win it back as it's stabbed away by Byram to Kamara. Back from him to Ampadu. Leeds midway inside their own half as they have it here with Cree Somerville. Short sleeve shirts and dark black gloves on what's a pretty mild night here. Easter, Monday. So nice to see the darkness falling just before kick-off. It was about 7:45 here. Oh, what a difference it makes once the clocks have gone forward. Ball played back by Ampadu to his goalkeeper Melier, and Leeds in control at the moment with 14 gone.
I think you're right, Jim. I think control is the word. They're just being patient now, you know, just taking a sting out of anything that Hull have got against them, passing the ball, not really searching forward until they've got a space to do so, and it just means that they control the game and they're in control because they're 1-0 up, and that's the way they like it.
Philogene on the Hull left. Played back by him to Ryan Giles. Now to Alfie Jones. former Southampton defender who's played the vast majority of his 200 career games for Hull. Seri to Coyle. Coyle able to get the ball under easy control, waiting for a little bit of movement ahead of him. Carvalho made a really good early run there, isolated against Ampadu, but he needed the ball to be played first time, dropped over the top, and the Hull defence didn't try.
Yeah, they miss it. Jake Greaves is suspended, and he's been their top performing centre-back this season.
He's serving the second game of a two-match ban for accruing 10 yellow cards in the Championship, which is why they've had to shuffle things around. It's invariably Jones alongside Greaves at centre-half with Cole at right-back, and that's why they've had to change things and pull Slater out of the midfield and drop him back at right-back. It's Slater that's got it now. Works it back inside his penalty area for Coyle and back for goalkeeper Ryan Allsop. 15 gone, Leeds 1, Hull 0. Here's Lucy Ward.
Yeah, you see Carvalho, I've seen him play for Liverpool. Unbelievable player, and they just need to get him on the ball, and they can't find him anywhere.
Now a great ball over the top, Philogene, and Byram came across, and Ampadu mops up and calmly guides it back for his goalkeeper. Mellier just side foots it with nonchalance out of the penalty area, although Roden does the same. He can't find Gray, but they thought about that ball over the top about 30 seconds previously for Carvalho, didn't play it. Then Philogene made a darting run in off the left hand touchline. They did play it, and it very nearly worked.
Yeah, and because of Leeds' high line and because of the playing those two forwards deeper, centre backs have to decide whether they go with them. It's always open to that run over the top, either from one of the two or from one of the wide players.
And they work the ball into a wide position now with Regan Slater coming forward from right back. Hull City still having the majority of possession. It's in the low 60s for them in these early stages. Put the ball in. Went too close to Mellier and away from the four who were there to attack it. Mellier able just to calmly pick up the ball on the bounce and now take it towards the edge of his own penalty area and run a few seconds off the clock.
Yeah, I mean, the ball in from Slater wasn't that good. Hull actually had four players in the penalty area, so a better ball would have caused some problems then for Leeds.
Roden frustrated with himself as he looked to play down the inside right channel for Patrick Bamford. The table changing all the time. Leeds up to second with that goal from Sam Byram as things stand right now. Ipswich 87 from 40. Leeds 86 from 40. This is their 40th game. Leicester 85 from 39. So if it stays this way, it would have been another absorbing, dramatic day, and yet nothing actually would have changed except the fact that everyone's played one more game.
Yeah, that is absolutely true, and there's been ups and downs all the way through the day, and I'm sure there's some more to come tonight. But Leeds can only control what they can control. Hull need to get themselves in this game.
Homer for Slater. Slater's ball across the edge of the 6-yard box, and he would have drifted wide now to play for a goal kick. Now Byram, I'm sure, didn't get a shout, and he elected to slide in, and he steered it behind his own goal, quite close to the post, but he was under control with it. But he's put it behind for Hull's first corner of the night.
Yeah, I mean, if Philogene had attacked that, they'd have got in there, and he let it go, and Byram didn't really know that he wasn't there behind him. But that's the sort of ball that Hull need to be playing. They do commit bodies forward,
and the corners weren't short. To Jaden Philogene, the former Villa man, looking for a little near post flick from Coyle, which wasn't forthcoming. Roots is back defending, and as soon as Philogene was there to close him down, he whacked it into him. So the play will restart with a Leeds ball. It's going to be a throw in the right back position.
Yeah, I mean, Philogene, we've seen already that he can score spectacular goals, but for me, he just needs a bit of oomph about his play. It looks like he's got everything, but he just needs to make sure he imposes himself on Byram at right back, because he's got the beating of defenders, because he's got that pace and he's got a little bit of trickery as well.
Jeff Stelling and Ali McCoy's are back on Breakfast tomorrow on Talksport from 6. They'll be reflecting on what's been a very busy Easter Monday of football, and looking ahead to the midweek Premier League fixtures as well. Don't forget, the only place to hear all 10 midweek Premier League games this week is the Talk Sport Network. 5 of those tomorrow night, with West Ham Spurs on Talk Sport, Newcastle Everton on Talk Sport 2, and the other games all available exclusive to national radio via the Talk Sport app. Today we've already brought you the best of the action from the EFL, including that sensational game between Ipswich and Southampton, and Ipswich winning that 3-2. And that is why Leeds can't go top tonight, can't go back to the summit, but they'll be back within a point of Ipswich as things stand. Leeds running, Coventry away next, and they've got home games here against Sunderland and Blackburn. trips to Middlesbrough and Queen's Park Rangers, who Leeds will hope will be safe by then, so there'll be nothing on that, and then at home to Southampton on the final day. But it looks as though Southampton's chances of automatic promotion are well and truly done once and for all now, because they find themselves currently 11 points adrift. They've got a game in hand, but 11 points behind the top two, and it'll be 12 if Leeds can hold on here. So Southampton might be in a position that by then, by the last day, they're resting players ahead of a playoff campaign. You never know. The fixture list might be working pretty nicely Leeds' way. Mellier comes out here and ends up having to almost hurdle Ozan Toufan as the latest long ball four from Hull saw Toufan get past Roden. But Mellier's got the ball in his hands and we're 20 minutes in at 1-0.
Yeah, I think Leeds are just taking the foot off the pedal. It just allows Hull to just grow into this first half without really threatening. There's a couple of balls into the box that have not come to anything, but they're not getting the players on the ball that can hurt Leeds, that's for sure.
They got it again here, Hull. Driving forward through the midfield. Morton instigating this latest move. Seri then plays it now for Ozan Toufan. He scored a hat-trick early on this season. Philogene has it now. Retreats a little bit down the left-hand touchline. Still only a yard in from the touchline when he plays it back for Ryan Giles. Giles back inside his own half for Jones. Now turned around the corner by Slater, who's playing at times in this inverted full-back role, coming forward from right back to tuck into a central midfield position in which he will feel much more at home.
Do you know what, though? Hull are not putting the ball at risk enough. There's too many of them want to get involved in the five-a-side in the middle third and look good, one and two touch, but who's going to make that darting run forward? Who's going to play that pass? They're not putting the ball, and I sort of understand it at this stage in the game, but they're 1-0 down and they need to win this game.
Yeah, the situation as far as Hull are concerned, they certainly have had a good day. Norwich beaten, Coventry beaten, Preston beaten. They're the three teams immediately above Hull in 6th, 7th and 8th places respectively. But Hull, as things stand right now, 6 points adrift of the top six that will constitute a playoff position. It's Norwich that they've got on their sights. If they draw here, they go above Preston. If they win, they go above Coventry as well. And they've got the chance to halve that 6-point deficit to Norwich. And they've got a game in hand on them even at the end of tonight. But they trail 1-0 at the moment. Fierpo to Somerville. Somerville with a chance to run at Slater. Pops the ball inside. It will be picked up by Reuter, who thought about a shot. Lays it off instead for James. To Somerville. Somerville to James. He stabbed the ball the wrong way. And it was cleared by Coyle.
I'll tell you what, Tyler Morton has got the wrong pair of studs on, or wrong pair of boots on. He slipped over in really important positions about three times now in that central midfield area. He's allowed Leeds through, but just Leeds there. Just show, every so often, Leeds show a little bit on the edge of the box. What this crowd want is to score 2, 3, 4, 5, and that's not always going to happen in the Championship.
Oh, goal difference could be important here. They come again, Leeds inside the penalty area. Bamford! It's an astonishing miss. He's had to reach out for it. He slid in, but the ball is 3 yards out. And he spooned it over the bar into the Norman Hunter stand. And he looked for all the world as though Leeds were going to get a second. Another classy, incisive move down the left-hand side of the penalty area. It's squared in towards Bamford. And he still doesn't know how he hasn't put it in.
Tell you what, Jim, if you're Leeds fans listening to this, all I would say is that there's only Patrick Bamford that can miss a goal like that, miss an effort on goal. He could score some superb goals and then he can get in front of goal and somehow scoop it over the top twice the height of the goal.
Yeah, you see that extraordinarily good goal that he scored at Peterborough, for instance, in the FA Cup. And you try and relate that moment of brilliance to that we've just seen. In fairness to him, his mitigation as the ball comes in at the other end and evades the slide of Omer, but he was offside anyway. In fairness to him, seeing the replay, there was a little bit of a bobble. Yes. The playing surface here is excellent, but it just did take a little bit of a bobble that made his life harder.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. But I just think with Bamford, sometimes it's just a lack of concentration that he, when he gets in those positions, that, you know, that he'll miss. And he's done it so many times. I think that's important to Leeds, but at this stage of the season.
Well, we're 24 minutes in, and the applause that you can hear comes from the Leeds fans who have turned their back on the game to remember their fallen comrades. Christopher Loftus and Kevin Spake. And even Ilan Melier, with the ball in his hands at the moment, has stopped. And the Leeds players stand and applaud. Things in football that transcend the game itself. And 24 years on from the tragic deaths out in Istanbul, ahead of a match with Galatasaray in the... always fitting, the players turning the fans turning their back on the pitch to applaud players themselves standing so that the tribute could be properly executed.
Great. Yeah, Chris will always be a huge part of Leeds United, never forgotten, and the club remembers, the players remember, and the fans, friends and family. Chris and Kev certainly will be in the crowd tonight.
Now the first poor challenge of the game has come from Junior Firpo here, who stuck out his left foot to make sure that Slater couldn't get past him. And he's received a yellow card, the first of the night. So Firpo in the book. His fifth yellow card of the season.
Yeah, Firpo's done well, Jim. At times, I mean, he had awful... Since he's been here, he's been awful at times, but better in terms of his assists. But when opposition teams play against Leeds, then they'll always target that left-back slot. But I think technically, he's just shown a little bit more quality this season, and obviously getting the assists and being part of a positive performing team, I think, has made a difference.
I'm not for one moment asking you to pick Daniel Farke's side for him, but do you feel that there's a better balance with him in the side, or
yes,
do you like it more with Byram on the left and Archie Gray playing at right back, or do you miss something from Gray when he's not playing in midfield?
Yeah, I think you need a left footer at left back. You know, the way that Leeds play, I think, even though they need a better left back, but I think there's more balance when Firpo is in this team as a left back, and Archie Gray is a top quality performer already at such a young age in that central midfield area.
Coyle coming forward here for Hull City, who trail by a golden nil. Sam Byram's ninth minute goal, the difference between the two teams. Morton in possession now, laying it back for Seri. Oh, Seri wasn't expecting the ball, and he looking to see what was happening upfield, and the ball was just played back to him, and he was able to react in time, but it was a close run thing.
Yeah, there's absolutely no zip or intensity to Hull whatsoever. They're not moving the ball quick enough, and I understand they want to stay in that defensive shape. They're always thinking about, what if we lose it? Are we there in the right position to defend? But when you've got it, you've got to commit and put the ball at risk.
Now they will bring it forward towards the edge of the Leeds United penalty area. Philogene, Tyler Morton on the left-hand side of the box. His cross well blocked by Roden, and it ricochets outside the box for Ryan Giles. Giles to Seri. Seri getting the return ball. Lays it back towards halfway. That will allow Leeds a chance to push out from the edge of their own penalty area. They're already 20 yards outside the box. Seri picks it up, trying to condense the play. Somerville slid in, but couldn't emerge with the ball. It's laid off by Omer. And then comes down towards the left for Philogene. Bamford is guilty of that astonishing miss a couple of minutes ago, laying it back here for Byram, the scorer of the Leeds goal, and he's done brilliantly to turn it back to Bamford, who just stood on halfway, waiting for the ball to come back to him in space. And when it did, he couldn't do anything particularly constructive with it. Leeds forced to work it back, and Gray was then fouled by Ozan Tufan. But Liam Rossignol is very irate, and he's raced out of the edge of his technical area.
Ridiculous. I mean, they're just so passive, Hull. It's ridiculous. Bamford was just stood because I think he was just having a rest, and Sam Byram did well, turned towards the touchline and played it down right into his feet. And it's just, if I was a Hull fan watching this, I'd be like, Leeds are making us predictable, so what can we do about that? Yes, we want to be defensive, we don't want to concede again, but there just needs to be a little bit more oomph and zip about the way that Hull are playing.
You're listening to Leeds against Hull in the EFL Championship on TalkSport with McDonald's. You can order McDelivery on the McDonald's app and get tasty rewards points. 18 plus, terms and conditions apply. It's Leeds 1, Hull 0. That's been the way of it for the last 20 minutes. We've now played half an hour. And Giles goes back to his goalkeeper, Ryan Alsop. Also playing the ball out from the back. Hull have had three spells in the Premier League. This, though, their seventh season in a row outside the top flight. They certainly would be punching above their weight if they were to get close to getting into the playoff positions. They do have one of the most highly regarded young coaches in the country outside of the Premier League. Ball play forward towards Morton, and Ruta's done really well, has come back, followed him every step of the way, wins possession back, now can drive forward, nicks the ball between Seri and Omer, and he's able to find Dan James. James playing against his hometown club, he's given it away, won back by Ozan Tufan. And when there is an individual error, there's still that little bit of nervousness.
Yes.
This stage of the season when it's so close and the teams are so tightly packed in that top three that it's impossible, I suppose, for a lot of supporters not just to let their emotions get the better of them and verbally chastise. But Hull are able to bring the ball forward again here. Ozan Tufan. Down towards the Hull left for Jaden Philogy. Philogy on the left-hand side of the box with a couple of little step-overs and then checks. Gets it onto his right foot, then back onto his left. Low ball in towards the edge of the six-yard box, and Mellier was able to get to. He kicked it away. And then James will help it forward towards halfway looking for Bamford, but he can't come close to holding it up because he's beaten by the dark-haired Jones, and Hull will move it forward again.
Yeah, Leeds fans are not happy because the Leeds players are just sitting back into a formation, not particularly sitting deep, but just setting out a defensive formation, and just then when they win the ball back are trying to hit Hull on the break. But obviously when you're a Leeds fan and you're at home at Elland Road, you want to see the onus on your team to, you know, to be front foot. But they don't need to do anything, Leeds, at the moment, because Hull don't look at the moment like they can penetrate.
68% of the possession for Hull through the opening half hour, and they haven't had a single shot. Leeds have so far had four, two of them on target, including the goal from Byron. And this Fabio Carvalho, former Fulham man, on loan from Liverpool. Now towards the right-hand side. Omer flashing the ball inside the penalty area, and it's looped up high in the air off Ozan Tufan. Didn't really know too much about that. Hit him and spooned up for Mellier to come out of catch.
Yeah, as soon as they sort of step up the pace in the final third, Hull, they look something like that. That final ball has been so poor. Carvalho, who probably is the best one in between the lines, cannot get on the ball, not getting himself on the ball. They're not finding him. So therefore, they're not really hurting Leeds, and Leeds are just making what Hull are doing predictable.
Has got four goals, Carvalho, in this loan spell at Hull, including significant ones against both Southampton and Leicester. Allsop had the time to take a touch inside the six-yard box, and it'll be cleared by the Hull left-back Giles through the midfield for Ozan Tufan. Seri working it wide towards Slater. Slater turning it back for Coyle near the edge of his own penalty area. Ruta comes to engage, and then James leads the press from the front. Hull calmly work it back for Allsop, and he will find Slater in space, the right back, and he's now got about 20 yards of verdant green Leeds turf to work with as he makes his way forward towards halfway. And the Leeds fans a little bit frustrated at the lack of pressure that was coming on the ball. Seri to his left, Ozan Tufan finding Jaden Philogene. Philogene trying to work the angle, right footed shot hit Roden, and then be brought forward again. And Morton's done well to keep his balance that time. Great ball in, it's 1-1. Fabio Carvalho at the near post. Brilliant ball in from Tyler Morton. And Leeds, a little bit too passive, just stood and watched. And Hull side through them. They've scored with their first attempt of the night. Another potential twist in this promotion race. As almost out of nothing, Hull equalise at Elland Road.
I tell you what, Jim, the Hull have had possession the last sort of 5 or 10 minutes or so, have had the control of the game without actually hurting Leeds. As soon as they actually have a little bit of quality in the final third in the box, and they move the ball quicker, get wide, get the ball into the box, they scored a goal. And Leeds, it was like as if Hull got Leeds into a bit of a lull of defending and in the shape, and they're not going to hurt us, they're quite predictable. And as soon as they moved it quickly, all of a sudden it's 1-1. The crowd were getting really anxious in that they were getting, come on, we want you to get out of the ball, Leeds, and get up the pitch, score two, score three. And now you've let Hull back into it.
And of course, inevitably, that Bamford miss looks even more important now that would have made it 2-0. As it is, Leeds peg back. Fabio Carvalho, we mentioned that he scored a couple of really significant goals against Leicester and Southampton, and now he scored against Leeds as well. 1-1, the lead lasting 25 minutes.
They've been building up to that though, Jim, Hull, I think, without sort of hurting. They've had the possession, they passed it about, tried to sort of see space forward and didn't go there, didn't put the ball at risk, and then, you know, recycle possession. And then as soon as they do that, getting behind, just Leeds just couldn't cope with it or weren't ready for it. And they need to get themselves going again, Leeds. You know, it was never going to be easy, was it? We've seen what happened already on Easter Monday today with the other teams. It's always going to be exciting. And Hull have got, you know, Hull have got something to play for. So they're not going to let Leeds just run away with this game.
Well, Somerville has been fouled by Slater. And it's a free kick that will be taken on halfway. Leicester were the first in action today. They were a goal down against Norwich, came back to win. Ipswich led, but then they subsequently went a goal down at home to Southampton and came back to win. So Leeds pegged back here, but the two title rivals have both come from behind to get the 3 points today. Leeds don't have to do that. They've just got to win the remaining 55 minutes of this one. 1-1, Byram on 9, Fabio Carvalho equalising on 34. He's involved now. He's scoring his fifth goal of the season. And he's won a throw, which will be taken over on the Hull City right-hand side. Daniel Farker just turns and looks very nonplussed at those on the Leeds United bench with his hands out. Just not happy at the way that this game has slowly, surreptitiously began to ebb away from them the last 10 minutes.
Yeah, it's like Hull lulls Leeds into a false sense of security. Like, we're not going to hurt you. We aren't going to look like we're going to score. And then get into a position where, hang on a minute, we can get sort of beyond. And as soon as they sort of ran beyond and got the crossing, Carvalho, who's not really been that involved, probably the few minutes leading up to the goal he was, but he's such a key player for Hull because he's just got so much quality. Made a great run and just got something on it that sent it past Melier.
Ethan Ampadu, who's had a fantastic season. As the commentator's cursing, he's given it straight to Seri as soon as I've said that. And now Ozan Tufan coming in off that left flank for Hull City. The referee does well to take evasive action as Hull pirouette around him. Jones to Coyle. Every outfield player in Leeds United territory. As Coyle works it wide out to the right-hand side, Slate has made his way towards the edge of the penalty area. The ball with Omer. Find Seri.
Sorry, Jim. All of a sudden, it's different now. Now it's 1-1 and Hull have got it. Now it's a problem for the Leeds fans. It's like, hang on a minute, you've let them get back into it, and now you're still letting them control the game. And you know, but that's not the way that Leeds play. You know, Leeds are winning the ball back, regaining possession, and scoring within three or four passes. And you know, Hull, we know what they're like in possession. They didn't look like they were going to hurt Leeds, and then all of a sudden, the sort of momentum swung their way.
And Hull will break quickly down the right-hand side again. High ball inside the penalty area, headed away by Roden. There's a really good cross that came in from Coyle, making his way forward from centre-half out to the right wing for a monk. Hull have it now with Ryan Giles. And the murmurs of discontent are growing in volume from the Leeds fans around us. Morton to Philogy. Play back towards Alfie Jones. And Hull coach Rossini comes to the edge of his technical area again and is bellowing instruction. Still not happy. He's seen his side get back into it. He feels quite clearly that there is more to come from them. Seri.
You just need to be so wary at Hull. If they lose possession, that's where Leeds are at the strongest. The best team in terms of regains and what they do with it in the Championship.
Now ball over the top. Ampadu's got to scamper after it because they are almost able to get Abdul Karim Omer in. Ampadu swept up brilliantly, and then Firpo gets it forward towards Somerville. 1-1 the scoreline. Leicester 1, Ipswich 1. Leeds have led but are now being held again as we come towards half time. 6 minutes to go here on Talksport before the break. And Leeds win a free kick. Reuter is fouled by Coyle, and it'll be taken by Leeds inside their own half with the Grey in a hurry to get on with things.
Reuter is the one for Leeds in terms of those central areas. He's sort of dropping deep, he's winning the ball. He's not done it since Hull have sort of had possession of the ball, but he's so key to that transition from when Hull have it to when Leeds have it and get themselves on the edge of Hull's box.
The Leeds home record has been so good, far and away the best in the division. The only unbeaten side at home in the Championship this season. In fact, since September the 2nd, they've only dropped 2 points here. It was Coventry that got a draw. Every other visitor in the last 16 games in the league has been beaten. Melier will race out of his penalty area and clip it away over his teammate Roden, and then it's forced an error from Giles. He tried to control it and it bobbled off his knee. Bamford gets it. Bamford to Somerville. Not a great tempo about a Leeds counter attack that allowed the whole ranks to reshape and reform behind the ball. But Firpo's got it back out towards Somerville on the Leeds left, level with the edge of the whole penalty area. Somerville turning inside, driving it across. James coming to meet it, and it might break Roots' way. Firpo sliding in, and it's bobbled via deflection, wide of the scrambling Allsop. He had defender Jones back on the line. He'd have been able to clear it, but it goes out for Leeds' first corner.
Yeah, it's good play by Somerville, and Hull just conspired to allow Leeds to have it right on the edge of the 6-yard box. Luckily for Hull, it didn't end up in the back of the net. But the Leeds fans are so funny. If Leeds don't play forward in the first pass, they start to groan, and it's a really loud groan because obviously, you know, they could sort of feel the pressure probably more than the players.
Dan James to take this Leeds corner. Only the second corner of the night, the first that Leeds have won. But first of all, referee Josh Smith just wants a word with somebody inside the penalty area. It's Ryan Giles that's being spoken to, and Giles obediently nods in all the right places, gives the referee a tap on the shoulder, promises he won't do it again. Now the referee wants a word with Carvalho and Ampadu, the two being spoken to in tandem. Seri throws up an arm in dismay. He's watching Ruta. So there's plenty going on inside that penalty area. James now attacks it in towards the near post. Didn't get enough height on it. It was volley clear by Giles and will bounce over the line and out for a throw which will be taken. It was Ozan Tufan actually that got it away. And a throw which will be taken on the Leeds United right by James. James to Somerville. Somerville playing it back to the edge of the centre circle. Roden to Kamara. Now Somerville over on the Leeds United left to Firpo. He'll go back inside his own half for Ampadu. And Leeds will work it further back for Melier and just try to draw Hull forward to create a bit of space in the midfield.
The Hull fans are the ones making the noise now. I think that Leeds fans are a little bit shocked that it's ended up like that, getting a bit frustrated.
Oh, James thinks he's got the run of Giles here. Giles just uses his body to come across. Was that obstruction? The referee says no. Daniel Farker thought it might have been even more. Hull work it forward. And Coyle ends up winning a throw for his side. What did you make of that defending from Ryan Giles?
Yeah,
Lucy?
I mean, I think he did well. Dan James is a lot smaller than Giles, and I think what he just managed to physically just ease him out. Now, obviously, Daniel Farker's appealing for something. I don't think it's something. I think the referee's actually done quite well. It's not often that Leeds fans will say that at Elland Road, that the referee did well, but I think he's actually refereed well so far in the opening sort of 43 minutes.
Yeah, he's got a really good reputation. Josh Smith, I don't think it's going to be too long before he's promoted to Premier League fixtures and select Group 1. Ampadu plays the ball forward towards Junior Firpo to Somerville over on the Leeds United left. 1-1 the scoreline here in a game in which Leeds struck quite early. But Hull's possession superiority has been rewarded with an equaliser from Carvalho. Philogene on the edge of the centre circle, back inside the circle itself for Seri. Seri getting the ball back.
It's
from
a good player, Seri. It's a good player. He's coming from behind the ball a lot, but he's getting into it now, and his passing is very good.
And he's got it again here. Just has a quick look over his shoulder to see where Bamford is. He can turn it past him, then shows for the immediate return ball from Jones. Coyle will play it forward over the top. Ozan Tufan with a little cushion header down. Philogene's got it inside the Leeds box, but he's got four in white between him and goal. Shot comes in, it hits at least one, possibly two of the four. And then Gray and Firpo between them can clear out of the Leeds United left for Chris Somerville. And he'll play it back towards the edge of the box for Firpo. Firpo working forward towards Glenn Kamara. And now Somerville chests it down. Gray will play the way that he's facing and try and release Somerville. He's unlucky that he just didn't quite get the weight right, and it's gone over the line and out of play for a throw that will be taken on the whole right.
I'll tell you what, Tufan did actually really well. He nodded it down as the ball was played long forward. And Philogene's he just needs to get himself going. If he'd have been a little bit quicker onto that ball and maybe shot first time, it could have been Hull going in front as they go into half-time.
Well, their last win was a 2-1 success at Southampton. Since then, they've had four draws, and the home defeat to Stoke at the weekend. They've got a really good record. Liam Rossini talking about his side's ability to be able to bounce back from the face of adversity. They've lost 11 games this season before that Stoke game, and they've won 7 of the games on the back of those defeats. So it's a good record. Giles shoots from distance as we go into 3 minutes of stoppage time, and he sent the ball almost onto the sign that says Don Revie stand. Wow. Let alone into it.
Yeah, I mean, it's been an interesting half, actually, because Leeds, when they scored the goal, looked like, right, come on then, you know, can you dominate this game? But they just allowed Hull to get back into it, and then Hull sort of got themselves beyond the back four of Leeds, which you'd not really seen that much in this first half, and got themselves a goal. And then since then, sort of Hull have had a little bit more control of the ball as well. Little bursts from Leeds, but nothing of a really high intensity that you want to see.
Here's Dan James in the first of the 3 additional minutes, and he's won another corner as he tried to fire an across. Coyle, who's had a really good game at the heart of the Hull defence, came to the left-hand side of the box and blocked it, but it is a corner that James will go across to take himself. Leeds second, and it comes in the second minute of added time at the end of this first half. It's 1-1 on Talksport between Leeds and Hull here at Elland Road. James raises his left arm above his head, right-footed, much more air underneath this one. It was a Hull contact and goes out of play for another corner.
That's a chance, isn't it, for Leeds to get themselves in front just before half-time. Key moment to score. All the hard work that Hull have put in may be undone, but Hull just trying to be as solid as possible defensively.
So Dan James to deliver again. This one deeper still. Everybody made a run into the middle of the 6-yard box, and it barely bounced in the penalty area. Will be picked up by Leeds' Glenn Kamara on the left-hand side of the penalty area. Chance for him to recycle it. He's played it back for Somerville. Somerville outside the box. Minute to go in first half stoppage time. James, great ball in from him. Nice shape on it. Half clear. Rooter stabs it towards goal. Allsop did well. Good double save from him. Kamara for Somerville. And it's hit Bamford in an offside position. That might have been going in. And Bamford has done the defensive work for Hull, and he's done it in an offside position as well.
Tell you what, Jim, that was absolutely all over the place. The ball was just quick. Lee's just trying to desperately get in a shot on target, and then in the end it came out. It was really good play from Kamara. He allowed Somerville the shot. I think it was going in the bottom corner. It's not funny, but Patrick Bamford actually tried to sort of knock it in, and they ended up clearing it instead, and I think he was in an offside position because he was behind the goalkeeper.
Yeah, it was a defender on the line, but he was indeed behind the goalkeeper also. So he was offside. But had he not been there, it may well have been 2-1 to Leeds. And that's the last action of the first half. Well, Bamford's been in the thick of it. He had a glorious opportunity to double Leeds' early advantage. He didn't take it. And he was punished by Fabio Carvalho's equaliser just past the half-hour mark. Hull with the majority of possession. And Daniel Farker and co. have work to do. Half time, it's Leeds 1, Hull 1, and if it stays that way, Leeds will be third in the table.
Wow, what an interesting 45 minutes of football. It swung both ways, as the Championship has done all day. It swung both ways from end to end. It was really interesting, actually. I picked up what you were saying in commentary after Sam Byram had given Leeds the lead. Hull looked so passive, and I loved what you said, and I looked at the game very differently when you mentioned it in commentary, Lucy. You said that they'd almost drawn Leeds into that passive play.
Yep.
And then caught them cold.
Yes. I mean, I don't know whether they meant to do that, but I don't think there's much zip to the or intensity to the way that Hull, yes, they keep it, but they didn't really put the ball at risk, and they probably didn't want to at that stage, because if you put the ball at risk, then it's in the saying, Leeds may win it back, and then they counter, and they're so good at that. But what Hull did, they grew in a little bit of confidence, and they've got some wise players in there, some experienced players in there, you know, the likes of Tufan, who gets himself in good positions, and obviously some clever players. And then all of a sudden, they do put the ball at risk. They get the ball in that left inside channel, good cross across, Carvalho gets something on it, and all of a sudden it's 1-1, and the Leeds fans are going, how on earth is it 1-1? Because, yes, they didn't really have the chances, Leeds, but they were in control of the game, and it looked like it was going to be all right. This is going to be 2-0 or maybe 3-0. You know, that's the way this game's going to go. And Hull have probably put a stop to that without looking that threatening, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that miss from Patrick Bamford, though, would have completely changed the game, because Leeds would have had their tails up completely, yep. Hull with their backs against the wall. We know they're good with their backs against the wall, but it would have been a higher mountain to climb. Ultimately, they let them back into the game. And as Jim just said there right at the end, I think that kind of sums up Leeds' first half, really, is Patrick Bamford in an offside position, the ball coming to him. he cleared it defensively.
Yeah, I mean, Patrick Bamford has done absolutely wonderful things for Leeds, but everybody who knows Leeds or knows a Leeds fan knows that that's the sort of thing that he can do. But you have him in the team, not just for getting in those areas, but about the build-up, about his movement, about how he sticks when it goes into him, and how he was one of the best players when Bielsa was manager, and he's doing really well now he's got himself fit under Farker. But when you're at this stage in the season and you're getting into April and you've not got that many games left, and everybody else is winning around you, they're the big moments. And if that had gone in there and it's 2-0 or 2-whatever, then all of a sudden half-time looks a lot different from a Leeds point of view.
Jorginho Rutter, though, has been a constant handful for the whole defence. He's been absolutely superb, setting up the first goal. He did all the hard work for that effort they just had just before the half-time whistle as well. He's some player.
Do you know what? He's quite an interesting one, because he looks like he wears his socks down. He's sort of easy Ozzy, but he's one of those players where opposition can't get near him. Mm. So the way that he moves his body and the way that he glides with the ball, it looks like he's easy to get the ball from, but they can't do it, which means that he carries the ball very, very well. And all of a sudden, Leeds, instead of being around the centre circle, they're on the edge of the opposition's box, and he chooses then the right pass, and that's where they got the goal from.
Yeah, and Tyler Morton, similar, because he stayed on his feet, stayed strong, beat his markers, put a great ball in from the left-hand side. I mean, it was a fantastic finish from Carvalho, but the work was already done from Morton.
Yeah, I mean, I'm getting a bit frustrated with Philogene, because Philogene just looks like he's got everything. But I just want to see a little bit more. I want to see him play at 100%, because I think that
it's decision-making, isn't it?
Well, yeah, it is. It's like quicker. Can you be quicker? Can you move the ball quicker? Can you have quicker touches? But Morton did well, gets beyond. I just think that I look at Hull and think that there's a few of those players that are playing within themselves, and I sort of understand it. If they were at home, then I'd say, why are you playing like that? But they're not. They're away. They're at Elland Road, and they know that any mistake will lead to a Leeds goal, which that's what's happened. It's happened all season. So they've just got to be a little bit wary, and I think that they're playing wary, and maybe if they can keep it like this to the last 15 minutes, Hull will make it about a 15-minute game and then change the way that they play.
Just quickly, either side likely to make any substitutions at half-time?
I would say probably not. I think both managers will expect the same, you know, better from each 11. I think that Rossini will be quite happy with his team defensively and just want a little bit more out of them in terms of decision-making in the final third. Daniel Farker, I would suspect, will just give a little bit of a rocket. He tends to perform better when he does that at half-time.
Yeah, it's going to be fascinating, isn't it? Interesting stat that Jim gave us earlier on, that Leeds have only dropped 4 points all season from being 1-0 up. Incredible, really. Could tonight be the night that they drop more points and lose a little bit of momentum in the title race? You're listening to EFL Game Day Live on Talksport with Ladbrokes. We play together. Terms and conditions apply. 18 plus. BeGambleAware.org. At the break, it's Leeds 1, Hull 1. Second half coming next.
Monday game night on Talksport with Ladbrokes. We play together. Terms and conditions apply. 18 plus. BeGambleAware.org.
With the all-new Mini Countryman, everything just got bigger. That means Mini's biggest electric range. Bigger technology and bigger adventures. With space for everybody. Even him. He's a good boy. And all this bigness comes from a Mini. The new Mini Countryman, our biggest Mini ever. Book your test drive today. Electric range 245 to 287 miles. WLTP figures of comparison purposes. Real life results may vary. Test drive subject to status and availability.
Like some kind of pizza ninja, Domino's are slicing their prices. Domino's Price Slice. Small pizzas now 8 quid, medium now 10 quid, and large now 12 quid. Yep, we're making cuts too. In 7th of April 24, minimum delivery spend, charges and areas may apply. T's and C's, see domino's.co.uk.
There's nothing more satisfying than a garden spring clean with Kärcher. Whether it's decking, patios, fences or driveways, dirt, dust and moss don't stand a chance against Kärcher's pressure washers. This is what Kärcher Clean feels like. Bring back the wow.
If you embrace innovation and believe technology can be magic, let's make it real. Introducing the new all-electric BMW iX2. With its connected technology and a sweeping curved display that lets you stream movies and play video games whilst parked up. Search BMW Electric to explore the full BMW Electric range. Features require a BMW digital premium subscription. App costs may apply. Details on our website. Test drive subject to status and availability.
That goal, that concert, that move, that feeling. It could only have happened here. Follow in the footsteps of legends on a tour of Wembley Stadium with exclusive access to the dressing rooms, press room and even the Royal Box. Plus, experience the journey made by the world's biggest names in football through the Players' Tunnel and onto England's most iconic sporting stage. Wembley's award-winning stadium tour kicks off every morning from 10. Book now at wembleystadium.com/tours. It matters more at Wembley.
Uno is now available in McDonald's Happy Meal. So let's see who can shout Uno first.
Bring it on.
Yes. Uno! A wild card. Right. Ah, yes. Back in the game. Yes. Uno! Draw one card. Ah.
Uno. Better luck next time.
Have fun with your Uno cards. Does that one count?
Nope.
Oh. Some fun, some food, it's all inside this Happy Meal. Until 7th of May from 11 a.m. Includes one pre-selected book or toy. Uno range comprises toys only, while stocks last.
Want to build the bet you want in seconds? With Unibet's Bet Builder, you're on. Add shots, corners, cards and more. And increase your odds with Bet Builder Rackers, combining bet builders across multiple games and sports. Download the Unibet app or visit unibet.co.uk and get a Bet Builder boost every day. Unibet, you're on. 18 plus, begambleaware.org, pre-match only, max stake £10 minimum, combined odds of 4-1 and 3 selections, T's and C's apply.
At Wickes, get Dulux standard 2.5 litre coloured emulsion, was £21, now £15. Be house proud with Wickes, ends Wednesday, terms apply.
On 1089 and 1053 medium wave, on DAB, online and on your smart speaker. Kick off the EFL live on TalkSport.
Leicester top, then second, then top again until the last gig at Portman Road. But now that stoppage time knockout Suffolk punch means that Leeds are playing to get back within a point of the summit. Getting towards the byline. First shot comes in, it's saved. And it's bubbled in on the rebound by Sam Byron. They come again, Leeds inside the penalty area. Bamford! It's an astonishing miss. He's had to reach out for it. He slid in, but the ball is 3 yards out. Morton's done well to keep his balance that time. Great ball in, it's 1-1. Fabio Carvalho at the near post. Brilliant ball in from Tyler Morton. And Leeds a little bit too passive, just stood and watched.
Live on TalkSport, Faker Others with you. Thanks for your company this evening here at Elland Road, where Leeds United lead it's 1-1. I wrote this before Hull equalised, quite clearly, and just anchormanned my way through the top instead. It's Leeds United 1, Hull City 1 is what I mean to say. Leeds looking to regain second spot in the Championship. Ipswich, top of the table at the moment. And if you've been with us all day or dipping in and out, well, you've had an absolute treat with all the twists and turns of the Championship. And the TalkSport Network has had you covered this Easter Monday.
It's Easter Monday, it's TalkSport taking you around the grounds, bringing you all the goals as they go in as we come to crunch time in the season in the EFL.
Sammy Smodics made that now 29 goals for this season, his second of the afternoon.
It's Coventry City 1, Cardiff City 0, and it's no great surprise, Ellis Sims who has scored it.
Keanu Hoover, 2-2 for Keanu Hoover. And Stoker level.
Swansea 0, QPR 1. What a huge goal for the visitors as well. And it was Steve Cook, the centre-back, who got it.
And it is Sunderland 1, Blackburn Rovers 5.
Middlesbrough 2, Sheffield Wednesday 0. The Borough double their lead.
And it's another sensational goal. West Brom 2, Watford 2. Darnell Furlong up from the back has just absolutely smashed home from 20 yards out.
Second half here at the Hawthorns has just been a goal of the season competition. Extraordinary stuff.
Sarmiento, it's in! Sarmiento has poked it into the corner. This is absolutely incredible. I don't believe my eyes. Ipswich have won 3-2 in the 97th minute. Never, never write off Ipswich Town.
No, you cannot write off Ipswich Town, Joe Shannon, that is for sure. And they are top of the table this evening. No matter what Leeds do tonight, they cannot take them off the summit, but they can close the gap to a point with a win and go back into second place, meaning it's situation as it was. But at the moment, they're being held 1-1 by Hull City, who are looking to try and get their playoff place secured again after a dip in form recently. That was how the championship sounded on TalkSport today. Remember also, we have exclusive commentary of all the Premier League games from the midweek fixtures this week. You can hear West Ham Tottenham on TalkSport at 8:15 on Tuesday, while Newcastle Everton is on TalkSport 2 at 7:30. Download the TalkSport app to listen to Forest versus Fulham, Bournemouth versus Palace, and Burnley against Wolves, while on Wednesday, Arsenal Luton is on TalkSport with Manchester City Aston Villa on TalkSport 2. All the other games are also on the TalkSport app, so as I say, go ahead and download it so you don't miss a thing. Couple of minutes until we kick off the second half here at Ellen Road. Former Leeds United striker Lucy Ward is alongside me. What do you think is going to be the most prevalent conversation that's been had in the dressing room between the two managers to their teams, Lucy?
Well, I think, you know, Daniel Farke will just, and he bemoans this a lot about the finishing, right? It's not just one play, and, you know, Bamford's missed tonight, but it's not always him. But it's when you're in games like this where, you know, Hull have seen a lot of the ball, they've not really hurt Leeds continuously. However, Leeds have had chances to completely change the momentum of the game if they score at those particular points. So he will talk about finishing, and I think that Liam Rossini will be looking at it thinking, yes, I think I'm pretty pleased with how they've kept the ball. I'm not happy with the defending probably for the first goal, and some opportunities that they've afforded Leeds as well, that they've been let off the hook when Leeds have missed. But use the ball better, put the ball at risk better in the final third. But it's going to be difficult for Hull because the momentum will build for Leeds in the second half.
Listen, we're getting a bit of breaking news here on TalkSport that Plymouth have sacked Ian Foster after only 16 games in charge. The Pilgrims just one place above the Championship relegation zone following that 1-0 defeat at home to Bristol City. It was their eighth loss in 11 matches. You'll remember that Foster was Steven Gerrard's assistant out in Saudi Arabia at Al Ettifaq before he took over at Home Park in January, and the home fans have not been overly convinced with their performances in the last few games, and that defeat to Bristol City looks like, according to TalkSport sources, to have cost Ian Foster his job. Here at Ellen Road, the Hull players are first out, ready for this second half, just doing their final bits of preparation ahead of this second half. Currently 1-1 between these two sides. Leeds looking to get back into the automatic promotion places and get promotion back to the Premier League at the first time of asking, but it feels as if this Championship season is going to go right down to the wire. It's quite incredible as it stands. This is Leeds running. Coventry away, Sunderland at home, Blackburn at home, Borough away, QPR away, and they finish with automatic place chasing Southampton at home here at Ellen Road on the 4th of May. All to do before then, with Leicester and Ipswich winning earlier on live on TalkSport. Victory would move Leeds back to within a point of top of the table Ipswich, and it would be as you were at the top of the table. A draw or defeat leaves them third. Let's see what they can do in the second half. Commentary comes from Lucy Ward and Jim Proudfoot.
Faye, thank you very much indeed. The two teams out for the second half. Hull first out. No sign of any changes for them. And no sign of any changes for Leeds at this juncture either. So Leeds, Melier in goal, Byron Mampadou, Roden and Fierpo, Gray and Kamara, James Ruter and Somerville, and Bamford for Hull. Allsop in goal, Slater, Call, Jones and Giles, Morton and Seri, And then Uma, Carvalho, Tufan and Philogene as a front four. But it's by and large a 4-2-4-0 formation. And they played it superbly, Hull City. So Leeds get us back underway in all white. And the stakes are so high and the difference is so small at the top of the table that there's a sense of inevitability that any failure for Leeds, particularly on home soil, will feel like a big kick in the teeth for this promotion challenge. Can Hull inflict one? They'd love to do it. The ball back for their goalkeeper Allsop, who will take a touch and then a second to get away from Bamford. He didn't do Jones any favours with the ball out because James was closing down on him very quickly. But Hull will be able to bring it away with Giles, and they work it very intelligently through the midfield for Fabio Carvalho, and Gray just lent into him. He feels he's a little bit unlucky to have given a free kick away, but it's a good free kick to give away because Hull looks as though they were going to break quickly.
Yeah, a little bit of an experience there from Archie Gray. Carvalho did well in terms of the way that he receives the ball.
Ambadou in there, sliding in strongly. Kamara playing it for Hull, working it back. They have won away from home this season, Hull, against the two sides who average the most possession. It's Leicester and Southampton. Leeds have the third most possession in the division. So you always have the sense that this wasn't a task that was going to be phasing Hull City. And they've got better as the game has gone on. And still Liam Rossignol, like an athlete on the blocks, poised almost on his haunches, waiting for the starting gun, kicking every ball. The ball is over on the Hull City left. They've lost possession. And Dan James can bring it forward now for Leeds. Running towards the edge of the penalty area. Giles backing off. James getting it back onto his left foot. A cross-come shot that might have been going wide. It was cleared by Coyle. Morton Such goes back to the edge of his own penalty area and will be cleared a high up and under. That's brought down well by Firpo. Kamara then laying it back for Gray. Stamped through the midfield for Ruta. He plays the way that he's facing back down to this near touchline. The lead's left for Kamara. Somerville lays it off for Firpo. Hull have got just about everybody back behind the ball as Leeds push forward towards the edge of the penalty area. Very diligently defending, and there are no gaps for Leeds to play through.
Yeah, I mean, Hull actually caused that themselves by just making mistakes, giving the ball away. Now they're back in defensive shape. They look all organised.
James, right-hand side of the penalty area, swept in! And Bamford couldn't get on the end of it. And he goes out of play for a Hull throw.
Absolutely fizzed it in from that right-hand side. Sam Byram gets in behind from a right-back position, just over the top of Bamford. He didn't really attack it, but I think it was coming that quick. They thought the goalkeeper was going to get a touch on it and actually was in completely the wrong place in the end.
You're listening to Leeds against Hull in the EFL Championship on TalkSport with McDonald's. Order McDelivery on the McDonald's app and get tasty rewards points. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. It's 1-1, 3 minutes into the second half. In the company of the Faker others and Lucy Ward, talking you through the action with me, Jim Proudfoot, here in West Yorkshire tonight. A strong challenge coming in on Philogene. Hull get it back inside their own half with Ryan Giles. Giles coming towards the halfway line. Hull, remember, if it stays this way, back within 5 points of the top six and have a game in hand. Slater trying to work it forward, and Somerville and Firpo couldn't quite combine. The ball goes out of play for a throw that'll be taken by Regan Slater on the Hull right.
Yeah, Hull at times defensively are really full tilt, you know, and trying to sort of keep Leeds out. Now, luckily for them, Leeds have not really had the finish that some of their players required, but they know that they're going to be under pressure in this second half. Leeds are playing towards the cop. The crowd are going to get loud, but you can just sense the frustration. Every sort of bad pass from Leeds is getting frustration from this Ellen Road crowd.
And there's one there from Ampadu, picked up by Carvalho, out towards Philogene. Running towards the edge of the Leeds penalty area, and he fizzes one wide of Melier, who I think had it covered as he dived to his left. He's got a big wingspan, Ilan Melier, and he threw out a left arm. And I think had the ball been going inside that post, Melier would have been able to get his fingers to it to tip it around the post.
Yeah,
the goal kick.
I think you're right, Jim. Philogene again, you know, he's shown a little bit, come inside, but they move the ball quick and it just slows down when it gets to him. But there's a lot of space in those central areas then for Hull to get themselves through.
Leeds on the right-hand side of their own penalty area. Get it forward. And it goes over James. Van goes out of play. It was that Vicarage Road on Friday, Lucy, and it felt as though it was in the face of an astonishingly good Watford performance, one of their best for two or three years in their first home game under Tom Cleverley. It just felt as though Leeds were a little bit lacklustre, and it was easy to blame it on the international workload with several players involved in the 120 minutes for Wales and Firpo having been absent from the starting lineup because of his international duty with the Dominican Republic. No Gruev either, of course, which is extremely significant. But this hasn't been a huge upturn for them.
I completely agree. I think the dynamism from the Watford forwards on Friday night really caused Leeds problems, and it made Daniel Farke have to change, you know, taking Cooper off and then moving Ampadu back to centre-back. But still, it wasn't quite right. And he has moaned about not having enough players to work with the international break. But Leeds have got a brilliant squad, which should be in the automatic position. That's what happens when you've got such a good squad.
Now Leeds have played out from the back and given the ball away. Now Ampadu do well to rescue an underhit pass from Melier, but Hull have won it back and will bring it forward. Seri teasing it inside the penalty area. The defensive header goes out of the left-hand touchline. Jaden Philogene stops it going out of play for a throw. It's brought it back here for Ryan Giles. Good delivery in from him, and a looping header ends up on the roof of the net. It looked for a moment it was a poor attempt from Ozan Toufan, but then Melier started scrambling and you realise that it was closer than you first thought, and it went over him, but just over the bar onto the roof of the net, and it stays 1-1.
Yeah, Giles did really well. Just whipped the ball in. Again, the crowd are getting edgy. And this is when I said about how heavy these shirts are, you'll see it in the remaining games for Leeds. The crowd, whatever the crowd are feeling, they'll show it. You'll get behind the players, but if they're frustrated, they'll show it. But these players have got to step up. They've got to be brave. If they make a mistake like Bamford has done, get back on the ball. You've just got to keep doing it. You've got to ignore the crowd. That's what you've got to do. Use their energy when it's positive, but ignore them if there's any sort of frustration, and just play the way that the manager's taught you to play.
Which I would imagine is infinitely easier said than done.
Absolutely. This place can get very loud, and this place is just as powerful when it's quiet, because of a quiet Elland Road means that the crowd are really not happy with the way things are going. And to be fair to Hull, I think that they've done enough to sort of frustrate the crowd tonight.
Well, Hull have picked up more points on the road than they have at home this season. This has been an archetypal Hull away performance against one of the big hitters so far. Firpo in possession for Leeds, and he's given it away. Just hit Omer. And then goes out of play for a Hull throw. The way that Seri appealed for it, it suggests that maybe he thought that it might have been a Leeds ball. But it is a Hull throw, and Regan Slater is coming forward to take it. Slater, ordinarily a central midfielder, but playing at right back. Lucy with just a little chuckle of appreciation for Seri's brilliance in the midfield, playing a no-look pass with his right foot scooped behind his left leg. It was inch perfect. Leeds won it back, hammer it upfield, and Allsop's forced a sweep up from outside his penalty area, and he's best to put that onto the TV gantry.
Yeah, there's enough indecision in Leeds for Hull to feel like a little bit of encouragement that perhaps they can get something more than a draw out of this game. But we know that Leeds at any point can turn it on and produce late goals, comebacks, whatever it is. But at the moment, Hull are just sensing and just sniffing a little bit that perhaps that they can get something from this game that's not just a point.
Well, there have been so many significant late goals in matches between sides in the top 8 and 9 this season. And today, of course, with Sarmiento's 97th minute winner for Ipswich against Southampton, as a yellow card is shown. And Ozan Toufan, the first Hull player to have his name taken tonight for a late injudicious lunge in the midfield, just catching Joe Roden. But so many late goals. You think that the ones that Leicester have conceded, both times that they played Ipswich, who equalised against them in stoppage time, the three Leeds got in the last 10 minutes against Leicester here. And these games really aren't over until they're over, and this one has got a lot ahead of it. Yeah, 1-1 the scoreline, and we've still got 35 minutes of the 90 to go. Morton, young midfielder on loan from Liverpool, picking up the ball on the near touchline, forced to play it back. Coyle now to Seri. Seri through the D towards the edge of the penalty area for Jones, who can elegantly chip the ball over Dan James and out of the left-hand side for Ryan Giles. Giles plays it forward down the line for Philogy. And Hull, not only great tempo, making their way into the Hull, into the Leeds half, excuse me, but maintaining possession easily. Giles back out towards Philogy, and oh, Giles has gone down. He's hurt himself. Philogy's going to put the ball out of play. I don't know whether the Leeds fans think that's a diversionary tactic, but Giles pulled up as soon as he played that pass. He pulled up and it looks as though his right thigh's gone.
Yeah, I think it might be his groin, actually. I don't know whether he slipped. I'm watching a replay. I will see a replay in a minute. But I think that you look at the Hull players and I can see why that they're inconsistent. I can see little glimpses of something special. But the one thing that they are is they're all comfortable in tight areas receiving the ball. And that's come from the manager. And, you know, I know a few of these players and I think they've been improved just being under Liam Rossini, but it's about putting that collective performance together every single time, and that's the difference between being out of the playoff positions and then getting into the playoff positions.
While Giles still yet to get back to his feet, there is a little bit of action on the whole bench. Now, I think they're there. The message has come across from the medical staff over on the far side that a change is going to have to be made, and Matty Jacob is going to come on, a left-sided defender, so he can fill in naturally enough. His last two appearances, one's been at right back, one's been on the left of three centre halves. A young man about to come on for what will only be the 11th senior appearance of his career. He's getting shown a few crucial bits of paper, where to stand and who to defend against on set pieces. And cynically, I would always imagine that I just know that if I was about to come on for a game against Leeds and I was Matty Jacob, I wouldn't be taking any of that in at all.
Absolutely not. I know Matty quite well, actually. I work in the Premier League looking after Hull City. He was a young player coming through, so delighted for him. He had a big smile on his face when he realised that he was going to come on and go left back. It's a great place to play football, but he's a young player. And it's a shame for Giles, actually, because I thought he'd done well from that left back position.
So Giles off and Jacob comes on, and Leeds, as you would expect, sportingly returning possession to Hull, who put the ball out of play so that Giles could receive the treatment that he needed. So it's 1-1 and we play 12 minutes of the second half here on TalkSport. Tomorrow, 5 games for you. West Ham against Spurs here on TalkSport, Newcastle Everton on TalkSport 2, and we've got Forest Fulham, Bournemouth Palace and Wolves trip to Burnley, all available via the TalkSport app. The only place to hear all 10 midweek Premier League games this week is on the TalkSport network. I'll tell you what we've got Wednesday and Thursday and where it is in the next few minutes. Somerville making his way forward down the Leeds left. The crowd not happy as he goes to the ground and wins a free kick that Kamara will take. He's laid it back for Archie Gray.
I'm not sure that that's a free kick to Somerville. I just really think there was enough contact on him, but the referee gave it because when the crowd are behind them, the crowd are right next to it and they're a little bit loud, but I'm not sure it was a foul on Somerville.
Melier plays it forward off the top of Firpo's head, brought down by Corlew, had time to take a touch, and then will release Omar on the left hand side. The Turkish international winger coming in off the right onto his left foot, working it through the midfield for Jaden Philogy. It's all pretty congested in the central area. Tyler Morton's got it. Morton with a little bit of time to survey his options, trying to work out where he was going. Ended up going back for Seri. Slater now plays the ball through the midfield. Omer to Morton. Seri's 15 yards outside the penalty area. Ruta forced him to play the hurried pass. Somerville comes back, but he can't dispossess Slater. Abdelkarim Omer has it again. Little 1-2 between him and Morton. Well read by Gray. And Archie Gray turning and in the end winning a free kick. So we've seen Hull make a change in force because of the injury to Ryan Giles. How long before Daniel Farke retakes the pack, do you think, Lucy?
Yeah, I'm just looking at the options that he's gone to bring on. Obviously, Teo Joseph came on and scored against Watford, and he's an option. I think he plays well. I think every time I've seen him play, he plays well. But I think he risks taking Bamford off, because Bamford will always produce a goal, even though he misses.
Now the ball has been given away by Leeds. Tyler Morton shoves it to his right. Omer! Nice, curved it just wide. What a chance for Hull to take the lead. And again, it was of Leeds' own making. One sloppy ball up the right-hand touchline. And from that point, they were struggling, never likely to get the ball back. Players committed in midfield, an overload on the Hull right. But Omer couldn't make the most of it. Goalkeeper was beaten, and it went a foot wide.
I think it was Rodon who they thought was got a foul against him, but he should have put that on target. That is almost a poor finish, really, from the space that he had. He needs to get it on target and make Melier work, but he didn't. He put it wide.
Hasn't scored in his last 31 games coming into tonight, Omer.
I could tell. That finish just needed to be on target. He was curling it in, and he had a lot of the goal to look at. Maybe that put him off.
Ruta turns in the midfield. It's inside his own half. He's done really well to work that between the lines for Glenn Kamara. Kamara, Bristol, plays it down towards Somerville, right in front of us. We're about 15 yards inside the half that Leeds are attacking. Ruta clipping it over the top. Header away from Morton. Another stumble inside the area. Ruta from distance, a bobbler, and he's not got hold of it at all. He's pulled it well wide, hooked it wide, about 6-7 yards at the left-hand post.
Yeah, Ruta, that is the worst, and by a significant amount, worst part of his game is finishing. He needs to score more goals, and he always looks like he's really shattered when he's playing, Ruta, but he just does so well to link Leeds up, to get in good positions to win the ball back. Passing forward is excellent, and he's always got that option forward, and he's a really important player for Leeds.
And he's only scored in one of his last 25 games here at Elland Road, and a lot of his goals have come away. 7 this season for him. Somerville out of the right hand side of the box. Leeds bring it forward again. Hull make first and then second contact inside their 18 yard box. And Roden, stepping up from the defensive line, has been able to force it away. And it goes out for a throw that Jacob will take for Hull City over on the far touchline. It remains 1-1 on the day that Leicester came from behind to beat Norwich City 3-1, which Ipswich won a 5-goal thriller with almost the last kick of the game at home to Southampton. And this one is one apiece. So a bad day for Leeds all round if they can't regain the advantage that Sam Byram had given them in the first half before Fabio Carvalho equalised.
Do you know, this game is right on the edge of tipping either way.
Here's James trying to tip it Leeds way. And Slade was able to open up his body and clear it right-footed from inside his penalty area. Leeds will come again. You can hear the encouragement from the home crowd around us. Kamara. This has been better Leeds pressure, more sustained pressure at a better tempo around the edge of the Hull City penalty area. Kamara, faced up by Omer, slides it down the line for Somerville's run. Cree Somerville back inside for Glenn Kamara, the Finnish international, once on the books of both Arsenal and Rangers. Back for Gray to Roden, Ampadu playing it for. Firpo again. Hull well back inside their own half at the moment. As Ampadu lays it back for Roden, just trying to invite Hull forward that little bit to give Leeds a bit more space to be able to play over the top into, but they worked it all the way back for Roden, and now we'll try and come forward again with Ruta. Somerville couldn't get it into his stride. It's come off his right. Achilles comes back through the midfield, and then he's lunged to try and get to the ball first. Hannah's given a free kick away. He's hurt himself in the process, Crescencio Somerville.
Yeah, that was what you would call, it looked to me, first glance, a real 50-50, but in the end, he stood his ground in the middle of Morton, and Somerville ran straight into him. And whichever way the referee had given this, I'd have gone, yeah, great decision. Either way, obviously the Leeds fans can't believe he's given it to Hull. And if it had been the other way around, the Hull fans will have thought the same. It was one of them where they both just clattered into each other.
19 minutes gone in the second half, and it still Leeds 1, Hull 1. Talking about the games coming up tomorrow, Wednesday, Arsenal host Luton on TalkSport, Manchester City face Villa on TalkSport 2, and Brentford against Brighton's on the TalkSport app. Thursday, Liverpool against Sheffield United on TalkSport, and Chelsea Manchester United on TalkSport 2. Manchester United will expect to be better than they were at Brentford as they take on the other side just across the road in West London, or one of the other sides across the road in West London in that game, which is live on TalkSport 2. Liverpool hoping to consolidate their position at the top of the Premier League Thursday night as well, although they may well not be top by the time they kick off. All 10 midweek games from this absorbing three-way title challenge in the Premier League live on TalkSport over the course of this midweek. But it's another brilliant title race, the championship that we're concentrating on tonight. Gray, oh, he's got it down inside the area. Referee says no penalty. Sherry was the whole player making the challenge. Gray made the run past him. Referee Smith gave himself a little bit of thinking time and then moved the arms across his body very quickly to indicate no penalty, and the Leeds fans still letting him know what he thinks or what they think of the decision.
I tell you what, Jim, he was in a good position. All I would say, I haven't seen the replay yet, but the referee was in a really good position to see that. It didn't look like too much contact.
Now Kamara for Ruta. As Leeds bring it forward again, Ruta to Glenn Kamara. Couldn't get the ball out from underneath his feet, and when he does, Somerville was nowhere near where he thought he was. Thought he was out on the left-hand touchline. He'd actually moved to the left-hand side of the box. Hull get it away. Leeds win it back with Ampadu on halfway. Back from him to Roden. Now the two Welshmen exchange passes again. Archie Gray able to bring the ball forward. Gray striding through the midfield, finds Kamara. Back for Ampadu. And to Gray again. Gray, hassled and harried by Tyler Morton. But he's maintained possession so well. He's always looked at home in the heat and intensity of this promotion battle, Archie Gray. And here's another view of this potential penalty play.
No, that is not a penalty. But basically, Archie Gray put his foot so that he was tripped up rather than it actually was a foul.
Now Seri has won it back at the other end, and he's bringing it forward just behind Philogene. And Gray's going to be able to clear. Sorry, Lucy.
Yeah, it was a good decision. Archie Gray just put his foot so that it was brought down, if that makes sense. And that is not a foul. Doing that is not a foul. That's just putting your foot nowhere near the ball.
You can see where Seri's left foot was going to go. And Gray put his foot in the way of that ball fired inside the Leeds penalty area now. James back defending, gets a touch, but can't get it away from Philogene. Tries his luck from distance. And it was a dipping effort that went over the bar, and Melier probably had it covered, but it was hit with real venom and swerve. It's still 1-1 midway through the second half.
I tell you what, it's a terrific strike from Philogene. And when I said that this game is on the edge, you wouldn't put a bet on who was going to win this game. Yes, you might move towards Leeds because they're at home and they've got the crowd, but there's something about Hull where they're calm in good moments. You know, when they win the ball back, they're calm, they take a pass. It's just sometimes they look a little bit that they might give something away in their own box simply because they haven't got their back four out that are comfortable playing with each other.
Well, Patrick Bamford has just given a free kick away, and the Leeds fan away to our left has suggested that that possibly should be his last contribution of the night. He didn't phrase it like that. Matteo Joseph is the natural replacement for Bamford. Came on and scored for about 25 seconds at Watford the other night. He was given about the last 6 minutes there. Be interesting to see how long he gets tonight. Ruta trying to turn away from trouble, actually turn into it. Fabio Carvalho, the whole City goal scorer, has won it back. And Aouz Antoufan will play it out towards the left. Philogene makes his way forward. It's inside the Leeds penalty area and he's won a corner, which is Hull's second of the night. First that either side have won in this second half.
Yeah, they just look a bit more threatening now, Hull, when they get forward because of the anxiety of the crowd. When Hull get it in those areas, it just sort of opens it up, and the players can sort of feel that. Can Hull take advantage? They just need a little bit more quality in the final third.
Well, it's a corner that Tyler Morton's going to take. And Jacob, blonde-haired substitute, waits by the penalty spot. Ball comes in over him. Roden heads it away. Out to Seri. He's had another excellent night in the heart of the Hull midfield. High ball over the top from Slater. Kamara can deal with that more than deal with it. He's volleyed a clearance. Straight ball for James. Seri has fouled him, and that'll be a yellow card.
I tell you what, Seri, absolutely brilliant. So this is where Leeds score most of their goals. When the opposition are out of shape, Seri just absolutely took Dan James out. He had to do it, and that is decision-making. When you're a centre midfielder, when you know you've got players up the pitch and that Leeds can hurt you, you've got to stop them there, and he had to do that.
Ninth yellow card of the season for Seri, the Ivorian. who scored stoppage time winner on his debut for Hull and hasn't scored since. 400th game of an excellent career today. Now Joseph's been called back as we speak. 20 minutes to go. He'll be on in a moment. Leeds needing a little bit of inspiration. Where's it going to come from? Is it going to come off the bench again? So Joseph, who scored a late goal at Watford to salvage a point, will he be able to come on and work his magic again to turn one into three? Leeds need somebody to do that. Hull delighted with the platform that they've laid in this game in the opening 70 minutes. And they'll also be confident that they will be able to create the half chances that they might be able to capitalise for another famous away win. For tonight, Jared Bowen, the only Hull player to have scored in this fixture for Hull in the last eight meetings. A 2-0 win here back in 2018. Jared Bowen got both goals that night for the club where he really made his name. Will Hull be able to get the win that will see them halve the gap to Norwich in six? Slater, Seri, under pressure from Kamara, lays it down to the right hand side where
I think they need to take Patrick Bamford off. I think that he's just lacking in confidence and belief. Looks like Joseph's coming on for him. Just needs somebody with energy and will chase every lost cause and put Hull under pressure.
Yeah, the ball comes up and it is 49 for 9. So Bamford will come off. Standing ovation for him as he leaves the field. What a vintage night for him. And Matteo Joseph goes on. Joseph, who scored the first league goal of his career on Friday. Got a couple in the FA Cup at Chelsea as well. What will he be able to do for the 18 minutes that remain? Joseph, an England under-19 international of Spanish descent. A player with an immense future ahead of him. So straight swap up front. And Hull are going to make a change as well. And they're going to bring Zaruri on. And Liam Senior just trying to get the message across to those in amber about the change that he wants to see. And now the change will be made. Tufan coming off. And Anas Zaruri will come on. The winger on loan from Burnley. Got seven goals last season as the Clarence won the championship. Has scored against both Southampton and Leicester in this loan spell. So Rory coming on for Tufan.
I think as well, I think you look at Rossini, he doesn't want to lose this game. And what you want to do, if you're going to go and try for the win, you don't want to lose it going for the win. And I think as a away team, you've just got to make sure, got to be solid as much as you possibly can against this Leeds team, who will get stronger as the game goes on. We've seen them score late goals, but that means that they'll open up spaces for Hull. So Hull just need to take risks at the right time.
Melier scampered to the edge of his penalty area to get the ball away there. So another free kick goes Hull's way. And Joseph with an over-exuberant jump to try and win the ball has caught Coyle. Hull have changed things around with that change. So Philogene's moved out to the right. Zaruri's gone to the left. And Carvalho is now being partnered through the middle by Omur. So that's the change that they've made. Joseph spoken to by the referee, nothing more than that. We've got 16 minutes to go, Lucy, at 1-1.
Yeah, it's going to be really interesting. Look at this now, and Hull have set themselves up really well. You know, they've got themselves forward into the final third when they can. They've not taken that many risks when they're doing it. They've frustrated Leeds to a certain extent, even though Leeds have not really finished as well as they probably could do, but you've still got the talent on the pitch for Leeds.
And Leeds will come forward again, and it's former Leeds man Coyle that slides in, gets it away from his hometown club, and out of play for a throw that Leeds will take on halfway. Remember, at this stage of the game against Leicester, they were 1-0 down, could have been 3 down at that stage, and ended up winning it 3-1. Still plenty of time for Leeds, but Hull, for their part, will feel that at the very least they deserve to hang on. Joseph again a little bit too strong as he tried to wrestle his way past Coyle. Another free kick goes against the young Leeds substitute. And again, I think the referee's got it right.
Yeah, that's the thing. Already, Matteo Joseph is causing more problems for Louis Coyle than Bamford. But because Coyle has got a little bit more experience, he's waiting to sort of feel that challenge and then going down. And so Joseph just needs to be careful. But that's what you're putting yourself about. That's exactly what you do.
Here's Coyle again. Veteran of nearly 300 games in his career. Slater and Somerville attacking the same ball. Daniel Farker had the perfect view of it. The throw's gone to Hull. And Daniel Farker is very quickly reliving the moment with the fourth official, Andrew Kitchen. Be controversial if Hull score from this. They'll bring the ball forward now with Slater. Slater to Morton and swiftly back again. 10 yards outside the penalty area. Try to turn. Rutra's come back and fouled him. And it's a Hull free kick. Probably right at the limit of range. 12 yards outside the penalty area, right of centre.
Yeah, they're actually moving the ball well, Hull. I think they're just completely ignoring the noise around and they're just trying to pass the ball. And they like I said, because they're all competent at dealing with the ball being given to them in tight areas, and they can move the ball well. And a couple of times now, they've got away from the Leeds defence on Hull's right hand side and Leeds' left and got somewhere. And now it's a free kick in quite a good position. Yet, like you said, Jim, I don't think they're going to have a shot from here, but can they work something?
Homa and Zorori are the two players that stand over this. Melier not taking any chances, has lined up a two-man wall. It's Ruta and Somerville. But it's odds on that the ball is just going to be teased into the far post area here. Zorori has done exactly that, clipping it forward towards the penalty spot. Didn't actually get it deep enough. And then the referee saw some pushing and shoving and has given a free kick to Leeds.
You know what, that's one a referee where he knows he's given a little bit of an easy free kick and so looks for an opportunity to just not even it up but give an equally easy free kick back to Leeds. Because like you said, I think that sort of passage of play was in Hull's favour by the referee.
It's Kamara for Leeds. Work back inside his own penalty area for Melier, who looks as though he was going to play it with his left instep down towards Ampadu, realised in the nick of time what the implications of that would have been, worked it then onto his right foot, then played the same pass, but by that time he'd taken Morton out of the picture. Melier can now play the ball left footed down towards Ampadu, and Leeds have it with Somerville deep inside their own half. 13 minutes to go. Leeds 1 Hull 1 here on TalkSport. Somerville driving forward. Firpo outside him. Firpo inside the penalty area. Joseph shows him where he wants it. Pulls away and hits the post. And Hull will get it clear. Only as far as Byron. Byron to Kamara. Great movement from Joseph as he just pulled away on the edge of the six-yard box. Flicked a left foot at it. Came back off the right-hand post. Somerville now. Somerville to Gray. Gray couldn't do anything constructive with it. Kamara does well to win it back. Fired inside the area. And Firpo, climbing over Coyle, has headed it wide.
Well, that's the first time that Leeds have managed to drag Louis Coyle out of that right centre-back position and then hit the space that he's left. And that's why they got in behind. Did really well down that left-hand side and they're sort of overloading Leeds at times in there, but just couldn't get it inside the post. And that's a little bit of luck for Hull there, that didn't bounce from Joseph inside and back into the goal from that far post.
It's a brilliant attempt.
Did brilliant. He's already made a difference, hasn't he, Jim, since he's come on. He's just got that energy and he just puts defenders under pressure.
He made a darting run in towards the near post, then peeled away. Saw that Matty Jacob was coming. He had to throw a left foot at it, but he didn't whack it. It was just about making contact. Trying to feather it, actually got it between the legs of the defender, and it's come smack off the face of the right-hand post.
He was really unlucky, really, Josie.
And the boos and whistles you can hear here are for Coyle, who was down for a moment. And then just as Allsop was preparing to take the goal kick, he went down again. And the whole medical staff are on, and Liam Rossignol immediately signalling that the whole substitution was going to be necessary and calling a couple of the subs over.
Yeah, Coyle looks in some discomfort, but it has just given Rossignol a couple of minutes to have conversations. We're just looking at a replay of that chance for Joseph. just trying to scoop the ball really delicately into that far corner and actually just a little bit too much on the angle, and it hit the post and went the other way.
So Corner now actually lying on his side while he's being treated. The opportunity to remind you who's still on the bench for Leeds. It's Cresswell, Cooper, Peru, Anthony, Shackleton, Gelhart and Crew. For Hull, McLaughlin, Ahayo, Traore, Sharp, Christie and Connolly. And it's going to be Cyrus Christie that will come on. Another vastly experienced player who can play in a number of positions across the whole back line, predominantly a right back, and who played in the Premier League for Fulham. He's played well over 300 games in the Championship in his career. And Cyrus Christie will come on here for Louis Coyle.
I think Louis Coyle has had a knee in his backside, and it's really difficult when the muscle goes dead to have any sort of movement. He's sort of seized up. Crowd are booing him, but you can't hardly move really, and obviously a substitution is going to be made.
And this will be Hull's last change, because it's the third juncture in this second half at which they have made a change. They lost Giles to injury, they brought Jacob on, and so Rory for Tufan a few minutes ago, and now Christie for the injured Coyle. And he's going to come on and play at centre-half.
Yeah, this could be a loss really, because Coyle has been really diligent at centre-half. Christie's an experienced player, but he's coming on in a position where he doesn't normally play, and he's got to get right into it because Joseph will not give him a second.
So that could be one of the key battles, and immediately Joseph trying to get goal side of Christie, who had his arm around the shoulder of the young Leeds substitute. Christie gets it away, no foul, at least no foul was given, and a throw to Leeds has been swiftly taken. 8 minutes to go, Leeds 1, Hull 1 here on TalkSport. Another pulsating day of EFL action for you. Remember, TalkSport, the only national radio station that will bring you the conclusion of this quite magnificent EFL season, and a title race that really is too close to call. I look for all of the world as though it was going to be Leicester by a distance for so long. Remember, Leeds were 17 points adrift of Leicester at one stage. Just think, stand right now, they're a point adrift. They'll be a point ahead of them if they can find a winner in this game.
Remember, we did the Leicester-Leeds game, Jim, before, just after Christmas?
Yeah.
And we just basically said that Leicester could lose so many games and still go off. That's exactly what that's the amount of points that they've dropped, and we never believed that could happen, but Leeds just got stronger and stronger as we got into 2024.
Well, 27 wins has always been enough for promotion from the Championship to the Premier League, and Leicester's win today was their 27th of the campaign. But I think those historical precedents can largely be ripped up because of the pace at the top of this season. As Leeds bring it forward again, that's a brilliant challenge by Jones, quite magnificently timed. Leeds fans want a penalty. Dan James has gone down. We had a good view of that. I'm sure that Jones slid in and won it cleanly.
Yeah.
And it's out of play for a corner.
He had to get that right as well, Jones, because you know how quick Dan James is, slid in onto him, and as soon as he gets in the box, you've got to get that right, and he did. He got the ball. Yeah, he took Dan James out, but that is not a penalty for me. I think he gets the ball first, and then it's a coming together both ways, similar to that other one in the centre of the pitch.
Yeah, that is a magnificent challenge, probably a goal-saving challenge.
Yep.
Hurt himself in the process, and we made the point that Hull, having lost two defenders to injury, have made all of their changes. So they can't afford to lose another player to injury. Leeds are going to make a change. Kamara's going to come off before the corner's taken, and Joel Peru comes on to replace him. Peru, who's been left out of the starting lineup for the last month or so. This is a sixth successive game in which he's been on the bench. One goal in his last 13 games, which came against his old club, Swansea. What will he be able to do here? 1-1, 6 minutes to go. Peru attacking the near post. The ball in towards Ruta, and Jacob volleys it away, and it goes out for a Leeds throw.
Yeah, just right on the edge at times. Hull, not tackle by Jones, certainly was right at full tilt. He had to get it right and did, and then Leeds couldn't make the most of the corner that came from it.
I'll have had the majority of possession over the night. But you would think that in the 5.5 minutes plus, probably a similar amount of stoppage time that's going to be added, it's going to be pretty much all Leeds. A point, a much better result for Hull. I mean, even they are in the position that they have to gamble to an extent. They need victories rather than draws.
Yep.
But clearly on paper, when they're away from home against a side who've hardly dropped a point here, a point would be a really good result for Hull.
Yeah, I mean, you've got to look at the game state, how the game goes. And, you know, Hull now, if they came away here from here with nothing, they'll be really disappointed. But what you can't do is take too many risks trying to win it and then concede a second, because you know that Leeds will just keep going. You know, there's sort of 5+, probably 10 minutes left in this game, and that Leeds will get chances, so they have to be solid.
The XG, for those of you who are into that, Leeds more than a goal clear of Hull in terms of the XG over the game as a whole. Attempts 8-5 in Leeds' favour. Only 5 shots on target between the two teams in 85 minutes, but such is the state of the game, the state of the seasons for both of these two clubs, that there's been plenty to excite here and so much jeopardy. When the 86th minute, it's 1-1. Another foul on halfway. Yeah. Free kick this time goes Leeds way.
This ironic cheers from the crowd, but I actually think the referee's done really, really well. I think he's made good decisions on the big decisions. He's done well.
The first half possession, incidentally, was 60-40 in Hull's favour. Second half has been 50-50. Here's Somerville. Somerville, left-hand side of the box, taking it. Oh, that could be a penalty. It is. Somerville making his way past Slater, who lent into him. Somerville went down. Easy decision for the referee. And Leeds United had the chance in the 88th minute to take the lead from the penalty spot.
I'll tell you what is Slater doing? What is he doing? Just let him go past and put it in, because he's given Leeds an opportunity for the Hull are going to come away with absolutely 0 points from this. And he didn't need to make that. They've done so well defensively and just making a mistake. Just let him go. Let him put the ball in across and deal with it there. And now you've given them an easy chance to win the 3 points.
Crescencio Somerville looks as though he wants to take the penalty. The ball had been handed to Joel Peru. He had spotted it down. And now Somerville has taken it off him.
I tell you what, they're putting each other off here. They're having, as if you argue in the 88th minute of a game, when you're going to go for automatic promotion, you're arguing with your teammates and trying to put them off. That's what Hull should be doing. Wow.
And Ampadu had to come, not calm things down, but he had to delegate the responsibility. Somerville will take it. It is 2-1 to Leeds United. Come as you like, straight down the middle, and they lead with 2 minutes to go on a night where they've had to be persistent and patient, but they strike from the spot, and all three of the top three are going to win on Monday. It's as you were, with 6 games to go in the race for the Premier League.
Tell you what, Jim, Hull City will be absolutely kicking themselves. They've gifted Leeds this win. They've worked so hard for 86 minutes and then just gifted Leeds that second goal and the winner. And to be honest, I'm not even sure that Leeds deserve it, but Hull, you know, that is absolutely terrible defending, but these fans don't care in here.
Another late goal at Ellen Road. A yellow card for Somerville for whipping his shirt off. But his 18th goal of the season is one of huge significance. Leeds 2, Hull 1. And they lead for the first time in nearly an hour. Joseph stumbling on the ball. Seri gets it back for Hull. Play back for Jacob. Turned over the top by him, and a bounce on the edge of the Leeds penalty area. Firpo watches it over the lines. A little collision involving Ampadu, who ends up face down on the turf inside his own box. It's going to be a goal kick to Leeds and Ilan Melier. And by the time he takes it, we'll be in stoppage time.
Yeah, I've said that this game was right on the edge all the way through the second half. A little bit nervy at times as far as Leeds are concerned. And I think the worrying thing for Liam Rossini is that Leeds have not had to work hard for that second goal, for that penalty. You know, his team had done so well, and I'm sure that's what he'll say afterwards. You know, we worked so hard to get to that point and then made that sort of challenge at that sort of time in the game.
Peru beaten in the air. 7 minutes of added time. That's what Hull have to find another equaliser. That's what Leeds have to hang on to the goal that will take them up to 86 points. One behind Ipswich, one ahead of Leicester, who've got a game in hand. That's how the table's looking at the moment. Mellier comes out and catches it. And we'll just wait for everybody to push upfield before taking it. He's going to waste as much time as he thinks he can get away with here. 30 seconds of stoppage time gone. 6.5 minutes to go. Leeds 2, Hull 1.
Tell you what, they've got like a machine-like... It's like a reliability that this will end up in Leeds' favour at Elland Road, and that is key. If they can keep that going the rest of the season, Leeds, then they've got a massive chance of being the leaders or second place.
Here's Carvalho. Hull not done yet. Zarouri inside the penalty area. And there's another poor challenge. The edge of the penalty area. Omer dived in. Did he go over the top of the ball as he tried to win that? It was Ampadu that had it. But it wasn't a criminal studs-up lunge from Omer. Certainly a sore one for Ampadu. But it's going to be a free kick to Leeds on the edge of their box. 2-1 they lead. So the top of the table right now, Ipswich 87 from 40, Leeds 86 from 40, Leicester 85 from 39. More twists and turns guaranteed. Ipswich left it really late. Leeds haven't left it quite as late as that, but certainly late enough to be laced with drama. And they haven't won it yet. Hull bring it forward. Foul by Gray, pushing the back on Carvalho. Zarouri chases after the loose ball to retrieve it as quickly as possible so that Hull can take the free kick. And Seri spots it down, hits an inch perfect ball out towards Jacob. Leeds fans thought he used his arm in controlling that. Ball has been played back towards Seri. Only Christie behind him. He's worked it down the right for Philogene. Leeds going to be making another change very shortly. Now I think that they're going to be bringing Jaden Anthony on. Hull have still got it. Over on the far touchline. Forced to go back for Allsop. 4.5 minutes of stoppage time to go. Zarouri tries to ride the challenge. Can't do so. Was fouled. Free kick to Hull. And they will feel that over 90 minutes, they certainly deserve to find another equaliser.
Yeah, a lot of teams come to Elland Road and just wait to be beaten, even if they go get themselves in front. I don't think Hull have been that, but they had to be perfect defensively and they had to not make silly decisions, and they haven't done that, but they've still got a little bit of time.
Ball is driven in towards the far post and Leeds knock it away. Brought down on the edge of the penalty area by Philogene. Joseph, defending well, comes back and has won the throw. Flicked it in to Cyrus Christie. And he goes out of play for a throw, which they'll take in their left-back position. After a double change, we're going to see Anthony and Shackleton come on. And the first player to come off is Somerville. So Anthony for Somerville will be a straight swap on the left. And Shackleton's going to come on to replace Byron. That's a straight swap at fullback. But what about the nerve of Bree Somerville? Having basically ripped the penalty away from Joel Peru. He had to score.
Hey,
and he did so. He's the epitome of calm.
Yeah, he did really well because Ampadu had to come in and separate him and Peru. So if you're going to do that and grab the ball, you've got to score. And when it's in the 87th minute, leave him more so. So fair play. He's had a terrific season, so you probably had no doubt that he was going to score.
Well, Jamie Shackleton's only seen 1 minute of league action since late October. He's going to get about three more here. Hull got possession inside their own half. About 3 minutes of added time, but that time will be further extended now. We've had one delay and a double change in stoppage time, so probably 4 minutes or so to go. Hull work a long ball out towards that left flank. Right footed, it's clipped inside the penalty area. Good header away from Ampadu. Ball's brought down by Seri. Little flick towards the edge of the penalty area, and then Joseph hammers it away. Into touch, into the east stand, and out for a throw that'll be taken by Hull.
Yeah, it's really not been easy for Leeds at all. You know, they get to this stage and should really be comfortable, but they're not, and they're just clearing the ball and just waiting for the seconds and minutes to tick down in this game.
Ball stop getting it forward. Seri to Carvalho, score of the Hull City equaliser. He's got it again, Seri, turning away from Joseph, who was putting the pressure on. Cyrus Christie to his left. Seri turning in the midfield once more, laying it back for Slater, who gave the decisive or seemingly decisive penalty away. Slater has it again, through the midfield to Morton. Switched out towards the right-hand side. Philogene, Morton making a good run ahead of him. Morton's got it right inside of the area, trying to lay it to a teammate on the edge of the six-yard box. It was clear. Back out to Tyler Morton on the whole right. This time it's a left-footed, very deep cross. Jacob heads it back across the edge of the six-yard box. Ampadu steers it behind and out of play for a Hull City corner in the seventh minute of stoppage time.
I tell you what, you can feel the nerves in this crowd. Hull have just not given up, and it's just been a few clearances from Leeds that just look a little nervy.
And here comes Ryan Allsop, the Hull City goalkeeper, sent forward. He's in the penalty area. The ball is hit in very, very deep. Heads go up for it. Alfie Jones beaten. Hull recycle it on the edge of the box. Allsop still forward. Seri guides it in. Coming around the back. A very good defensive header from one of the Leeds players. Still Hull win it. Right-footed ball through the six-yard box is cleared by Ampadu. Allsop sprinting to get back in position. It's nowhere near yet. They've had a shot from distance. It is brilliant. On the right-hand touchline, Dan James scores from 50 yards. He had such a miserable week last week, but he has scored an epic goal here to seal victory for Hull City. Touchline, 50 yards out, he's wrapped his right foot around it and sent it into the empty net. Leeds have beaten Hull. It's as you were at the top of the championship, an extraordinary day of action, but the top three have all won. Leeds 3, Hull 1.
Tell you what, just before that break from Leeds, and it was a terrific finish from Dan James, and obviously Allsop found himself up for the corner, but I think it was Zorori strode into the area and was clipped by a Leeds defender, and he didn't go down. He had a strike on goal, and that was then cleared, and then Leeds go and score. Small, fine margins, Jim. That's what this game's all about.
1-1 with 2 minutes to go. Leeds now lead it 3-1. Well, this will certainly be a fixture they'll be glad to get out of the way. They haven't been at their best. Weren't at their best at Watford. They haven't been at their best tonight. But they will have done enough. And it might be the end of Hull's chase for a playoff place. A sixth game without a win for them, despite a performance that's had so much encouragement, except for the result. And at this stage of the season, results all that matter. Seri's whacked one in from 25 yards. Melier's made a comfortable stop. He played 8.5 minutes of stoppage time and still time for a little bit more. Liam Rossini stands on the edge of his technical area with his arms folded, affecting a look of nonchalance. And he'll be pleased with so many aspects of the performance, but the bottom line is they've been beaten in this Yorkshire derby. Leeds United get the job done, as they always seem to do here at Elland Road. It's a game that they scored first, they were paid back, and they left it really late to find a way through. An 88th minute penalty, a 97th minute sealer from 50 yards out. The history books will tell you that Leeds have beaten Hull by 3-1. Everybody here at Elland Road tonight knows that doesn't begin to tell the story. But the bottom line is they are back within a point of Ipswich at the top of the table and will still regard themselves as favourites to win the title. A big win for Leeds United. They've seen off Hull 3-1.
Wow, what an incredible game of football. Another one on the Talksport Network in what's been an incredible day in the EFL Championship. Daniel Farker said that his lead side never give up. Another late win for them. We talked to Lucy Ward about mentality before this game, and they certainly showed that tonight.
Yeah, I don't think it was... At this stage in the season, it's not about the performance, it's about the results. And Leeds didn't particularly play well. I think Hull will be proud of how they played, but it's about getting over the line and getting... And they were under pressure because of what Leicester and what Ipswich had done today. They were under pressure to get that win. But they've got to make sure that they... I think when they're in control of games like that, they've got to put Hull away earlier than they did, but they couldn't do it.
Nope, they couldn't. The fact that Ryan Alsop went up for the corner for Hull, then stayed up for that attack, does that show that Hull knew that they needed at least a point to stay in the playoff hunt?
Yeah, I completely agree with you, Faye. I honestly, I would like to see it again, that end bit. I think it was Zorori who had a shot, but just before he had a shot, he took it around the Leeds player and he got clipped, and it would have been really interesting if it had gone down, whether it had got anything. But then obviously it goes to the other end, Leeds score a third and Leeds win quite comfortably in the end in terms of the scoreline, but not necessarily the performance. But great mentality, it's all about the win.
Yeah, it is all about the win, and it's all about Leeds United. But 6 games without a win for Liam Rossignol, and although other games went their way today with Norwich, Coventry and Preston losing, is that it for their playoff chances?
Yeah, I think so. I think they've got... they picked up another couple of injuries today. I think that's what they struggle with. I think if they'd have had their back four, their proper back four, with Louis Coyle at right back and then Jake Greaves playing in centre back, I think that they would have been a little bit better in terms of how they responded to Leeds. But as soon as Coyle went off, that Leeds got more into the area. Slater makes a poor challenge, a centre midfielder at right back making a midfielder's challenge in the area when he didn't need to, and it just turns the game on its head.
Yeah, it certainly did. And Patrick Bansford and Jorginho Ruta just soaking up the crowd in the Don Revy stand on our left hand side here. The players doing a lap of appreciation for the fans who had a quiet spell during this game. There was a massive lull when Hull were well on top and Leeds finally started to turn the screw and got a little bit lucky. Stupid penalty ultimately given away, and then that really strange moment between Peru and Crescencio Somerville, who decided to take the ball off him. I mean, if you're Daniel Farker standing in your technical area, you're not happy with that.
No, it's happy because they scored, but it just meant that Ampadu had to go and sort them out. As captain, he had to go and sort them out. Because what it does, what you try and do as an opposition is you try and put off the penalty taker, but Leeds were putting their own penalty taker off. But it works out in the end. The Leeds fans are happy. And Leeds is a little bit different because in football, there's 3 results, and for most teams, 2 results are all right. But for Leeds, they have to win. And if they don't, particularly at this point in the season of the Championship where they could get automatically promoted, they have got a squad that should get automatically promoted, and that puts extra pressure on. But they've got through that pressure tonight and got the 3 points.
Yep, they certainly have. 6 games to go for Leeds United to try and get back into the Premier League. Coventry away, Sunderland at home, Blackburn at home, Borough away, QPR away, Southampton at home on the 4th of May is all Daniel Farker's side need to get themselves back into the Premier League. A pleasure as always. Lucy, are they going to do it?
Yeah, I fully expect Leeds to do it. I think they've got the squad and I think there'll be ups and downs, but I think they'll do it, yeah.
Well, I think these fans think they're going to do it as well, but I'm sure they've got quite a few nervy moments left to go as we have 5 weeks left of this scintillating Championship season left to play. Remember as well, the Premier League is so tight this season as well, and we've got exclusive commentary of all 10 Premier League games from the midweek fixtures. You can hear West Ham Tottenham on TalkSport at 8:15 on Tuesday, while Newcastle Everton is on TalkSport 2 at 7:30. You can download the TalkSport app to then listen to Forest, Fulham, Bournemouth Palace and Burnley Wolves as well. On Wednesday, it's Arsenal Luton on TalkSport and Manchester City Aston Villa on TalkSport 2. Here at Elland Road, though, it's finished Leeds United 3, Hull City 1. Another late goal in a dramatic day in the Championship. And the race for automatic promotion is still neck and neck. It's situation as you were. 2 points still separating the top three after Leicester and Ipswich also won earlier today. Leeds are back into second place, a point behind Ipswich with 6 games left to play. Hull's playoff hopes take another dent, though. Is it all over for them? They stay ninth. But the Championship never fails to deliver here on TalkSport, and we'll do it all again on Saturday.